So come on down and find a seat. It's 11 o'clock. We said we would start at 11, so we will do so. I anticipate we'll go for 2 hours at a minimum. There's a gale warning out in effect for later on this afternoon, so if we can end in 2 hours, we can catch our ferry, but if we can't, then we'll stay overnight on Nantucket, so don't worry about that. We're not going to cut short the discussion, although there are some fishermen who have come over from the mainland who probably will leave early as a consequence of the need to catch that ferry. So we'll see how it plays out. My name is David Pierce. I'm the director of the Division of Marine Fisheries, and with me is Daniel McKiernan, who is my deputy director. We're both in the Boston office. And also with us is Raymond Kane. Ray is the chairman of our Marine Fisheries Advisory Commission, with which we work very intimately. All of my recommendations regarding what needs to be done in the Commonwealth for rules and regulations, and we bring those recommendations to the Marine Fisheries Advisory Commission for their consideration and for a hope for approval. So we work very closely with the commission. There's a 9-member commission, so Ray is here representing commission members. Now, there are some seats in the front. If you care to have a seat, please do so. It's not going to interrupt me. I've been the director of the division for a few years now, and I've been with the Division of Marine Fisheries for more than a few years, since 1972. Started off with research within the Division of Marine Fisheries, doing a lot of work with fishermen, commercial primarily, doing a lot of work in the field, working on winter flounder projects, the Cape Cod Canal power plant project, and then in 1978, I began to work on marine fisheries rules and regulations out of the Boston office, working very closely with the commission, working with the New England Fishery Management Council. I believe we have one member of the council here today. That's Eric Reed. Eric is in the front. I don't think anyone else is from the New England Council. I'm on that council. So there are two members from the council here to also listen to the discussion, since obviously concern about the squid fishery, support for it or opposition to it in state waters or nearby, that's something that is reflected by those individuals who are concerned with federal waters fisheries and, of course, with state waters fisheries for squid. So I'm a scientist by education, a fisheries manager by hard knocks. I've had well over 30 years of dealing with important issues, marine fisheries management issues that are germane to what we do on the North Shore, on the South Shore, and of course in Nantucket Sound and around the island. So a lot of history within the division, with me and Dan in particular, having played a major role in the functioning of the division for quite a few decades, all focused on how to have sustainable fisheries, how to properly manage our fisheries in state waters, and to cooperate with other states and also with New England Fishery Management Council initiatives. So here we are on Nantucket. My intent is to give a presentation describing the rationale that I used relative to the petition that was filed by the Nantucket Selectmen, you know, with my agency specific to me, asking me to take certain actions relative to the fishing around Nantucket Island. So I'm going to go over the rationale that I used to not support that petition. Now, we did have a public hearing plan for Nantucket a while ago, about a month ago, to air the petition, to field public comment on it, and that, obviously that's why we're here today. That hearing was canceled because of bad weather, but clearly this is an issue of interest to fishermen on and off the island, residents on and off the island, so it made a lot of sense to come here to explain my position and then to get comment, pro and con, regarding, you know, my decision about that petition. We have a great working relationship with a number of individuals on Nantucket, and frankly, out of respect for those individuals, out of respect for those here on the island, we said we need to come out and hear what you have to say, and then move on in one way or another. So after I give this presentation, I'm going to turn to the selectmen to ask for any specific comments they have relative to the petition. I believe there is a scientist from the Marine Biological Laboratory. Maybe he's retired now. I'm not sure. Dr. Hanlon. My understanding is there's going to be a Skype-in regarding some comments he would like to make relative to squid spawning, reproduction of squid. So we'll see if we can arrange that. I think it's queued up and ready to go. And then we'll turn to representatives, senators, whoever may wish to speak on this issue. I believe Senator Sear has forwarded some formal comments, and his representative is here. I'll turn to him and ask him also to have some remarks if he cares to make them. And then I'll open the floor and hear comments, pro and con, on this issue that obviously is of great importance to many people. So here is what was requested of me. This is the petition offered up by the selectmen that the Division of Marine Fisheries should implement a mobile gear closure with no exceptions for municipal waters around Nantucket, Tuckernuck, Muskeget from May 1 through October 31st of each year. And then additionally, the request was made for state regulations to establish a minimum mesh size in squid trawls and prohibit the use of net strengtheners. But I believe the emphasis really was on that first bullet, mobile gear fishing around the island. And not just for squid, but for any mobile gear fishing, be it for fluke, winter flounder, you name it, it would affect everyone if indeed this was to be adopted and implemented for waters around Nantucket. The squid fishery, I think most of you understand what the squid fishery is, where it takes place. I'll highlight a little bit of that information so everyone's on the same page. This is a shot of the deck of squid trawler after a couple of successful squid tows. Now, Dan McCannon and I have a lot of history with the squid fishery. Back when we were little boys, well, actually not quite that young, but when we were a lot younger, when we started off with the Division of Marine Fisheries, I think this is 1995, we did quite a bit of research in Nantucket Sound, in Vineyard Sound, specific to the Lolago squid fishery. So there's a report available on our website. Anyone can go to it and take a look. This was 1995, Lolago squid fishery in Nantucket in Vineyard Sounds. Now, in that report, and of course subsequent to it, quite a lot of concern has been raised about forage, the importance of forage, fish eat fish, fish eat squid. These are, of course, some of the important forage species that we have in our waters and elsewhere. Menhaden in the upper left, sea herring on the right, and then, of course, squid, Lolago squid in the lower right-hand corner. Forage is important for predators. Predators need these fish, these squid, as an important source of food. So forage is at the top of the list, top of the agenda for many fisheries managers as something that needs to be examined, how much forage is needed in order to have a so-called healthy ecosystem with food available for the predators, of course, that are bound in our coastal waters and in federal waters as well. We can't forget that in addition to being a very important forage species, squid is found in restaurants. It's a very important commercial fishery, has been for many, many years. Offshore waters, inshore waters, all year round. Squid rings, baked stuff, squid. Everyone, consumers, I think, have developed a taste for squid. So that's one reason why the commercial fishery is considered to be important. It needs to be regulated, it needs to be managed, but at the same time, there's forage needs and there's also the needs of the consumer. Now, this is the newspaper article that appeared in the Cape Cod Times not too long ago. Island fishermen implore the state to protect local squid. That indeed was the request reflected by the selectmen's petition. So Doug Fraser of the Cape Cod Times put together this very informative and accurate article with at the bottom being, quote, this was where all the bass were caught. Now bait, no fish, no stripers to speak of. And this is a comment that was put in this article by Pete Kaiser, who is here in the front. Pete, who I've known for a long time, who I've worked with for a long time, an individual for whom I have great respect, especially his sense of humor and his expertise. Thumbs up, I know Pete. Anyways, charter boat captain and commercial tuna fisherman, and of course, Pete's been around. He's well known on the island as one of the more famous or infamous, I think, charter boat captain. And here he is with a shark taking on one of his journeys into state or federal waters. And then the Althea K, which is his charter boat operation with a very successful trip. There are quite a few codfish, I believe. That's right, Bassett. My eyes are failing me. Anyways. Holiday for Heroes? Oh, super, okay. All right, well, anyways, you know, Pete has been one of the champions of this particular initiative, of the need to be concerned about mobile gear fishing in state waters, notably around Nantucket. You know, Pete actually is an advisor for the Mid-Atlantic Fishery Management Council. He advises on squid, maybe mackerel and butterfish, but certainly on squid. And his comments have had an effect on a number of individuals associated with the Mid-Atlantic Council. And I had to put this up, Pete, because I did notice recently that you are on the web. So I listened to the presentation that you provided. I thought I should highlight this again to note your enthusiasm and dedication to this particular initiative. Protection of the Nantucket Marine Ecology. I suggest people take a look at it. It's about 25 minutes long. Pete, you better check this particular slide because it says protection of the Nantucket Marina Ecology. Now, I know that you're charter boats in marina, so better correct that one. I know it. Also in the Cape Cod Times, shortly after the article by Doug Frazier was published, this appeared. Cape Cod Times cheers and jeers. They have a column on the editorial page where they say thumbs up or thumbs down for whatever may happen to be in vogue, whatever may happen to be the topic of the day. So it noted that some 1,200 people have signed a petition asking the State Division of Marine Fisheries to prohibit fish draggers and scallopers, the tow nets or large metal dredges, from working the waters up to 3 miles from Nantucket. And then towards the bottom where I've surrounded it with red, saying there's limited science to support the new rule, the Division of Marine Fisheries Director David Pierce said he is opposed to it. That's good news. We encourage Nantucket fishermen to examine other alternatives to the lack of striped bass in traditional spots. And I should highlight that the position that I took on this petition was based on a lot of advice and research done by my staff specific to all the issues raised by the Nantucket selectmen about striped bass, about forage, about a number of other issues, habitat concerns as well. So I thought I should point that out. And also point out that this issue of squid fishing off of Martha's Vineyard in Nantucket, in state waters and in federal waters, which of course is where the majority of the squid fishing occurs, spring and summer, Captain John McMurray. This is something that was published as part of the Marine Fish Conservation Network. And it says, in Martha's Vineyard in Nantucket, there ain't no stripers. Captain John McMurray, owner and operator of One More Cast Charters in Oceanside, New York. And he's quoted as saying, an aggregation of small mesh bottom trawls off the coast could be ruining a historically significant striper fishery. Now, Captain John McMurray sits on the Atlantic States Marine Fisheries Commission's Striped Bass Advisory Panel. He also represents New York on the Mid-Atlantic Fishery Management Council. So any discussion about this issue on the Mid-Atlantic Council actually is promoted by Captain McMurray. And Captain McMurray actually has indicated to the Mid-Atlantic Council that any action relative to squid should involve a public hearing, any federal action, should involve a public hearing either on Nantucket or in Hyannis somewhere on the Cape. So he has been watching this issue very carefully because the Mid-Atlantic Council has a responsibility for writing the management plan, the rules and regulations for squid in federal waters. So there's a management plan for squid in federal waters. It's been in place for quite a long time, and they continue to revise that management plan. I also thought I should highlight this particular article in the Martha's Vineyard Times. Squid trawlers leave a wake of death south of the island. Trawlers from across the eastern seaboard leave behind miles of dead and dying bycatch in one of New England's richest squid breeding grounds. So obviously, the squid fishery in state waters and federal waters has generated a lot of public interest and has captured the attention of the media, and in this particular case, the Martha's Vineyard Times. So, all right, those are scup, some hake in this particular photo. It brings attention to the fact that when you have small mesh fishing, nets that are, you know, towed, small mesh nets, you are going to have a bycatch. Something is going to be caught that fishermen don't want, but it's an unavoidable catch that fishermen try to avoid, but they can't. Not always. There is always going to be some bycatch. This is a table that shows cumulative observed totals over 9 years. All right, this is National Marine Fisheries Service information obtained from observers. These data come from 2007 through 2015 trips where greater than 40% of the total catch was long fin squid, Lolago squid. This is trimester two, which is May, June, July, and August. They break it down by trimester. And you can see in this particular table that squid observed catch, again, this is cumulative over those years, about 3 million pounds. And then there are tallies of all the other takes of different species. For example, scup. Again, all locations, I have to emphasize that, this is all locations up and down the coast. This is not in waters off of Nantucket. This is waters south of Nantucket, Martha's Vineyard, Long Island, Block Island, all the way down New York and New Jersey. So observed discard of scup, which is, here's the scup, 248,000 pounds were caught, and they 190,000 pounds were discarded over all of those years, cumulative taking. Squid mops, okay, these are the eggs that are laid by squid and the gelatinous fingers. It indicates here that the observed catch over all those years by draggers in the second trimester was about 8,874 pounds, and it was all discarded, obviously, because clearly there's no use of squid mops. They just put back into the ocean. So that's some of the data that has been provided by the Mid-Atlantic Council, and we use that information, obviously, because it's from the Observer Program of the National Marine Fisheries Service, notably the Northeast Fisheries Science Center out of Woods Hole. So, Nantucket Sound. Nantucket Sound, these are the closures that have been in place in Massachusetts waters for quite a long time. This is the May 1 through October 31st closure that goes from Suckernesset Point in Mashpee all the way around Monomoy Island up to this area, which I believe is off of Nauset, May 1 through October 31st. The town of Nantucket, the selectmen, indicated in the petition and the logic for it, that particular closure should be applied around Nantucket. If it's good for this goose, it should be good for this gander. Currently, we have relatively small time-wise closures. This is April 1 through the 30th. And then this area here is June 1 through September 15. And I'm quick to point out that this particular closure to mobile gear was implemented by the Division of Marine Fisheries through regulation, not by law, through regulation about 25 years ago or so. And that came about largely because of my initiative. The midwater trawlers for scup were actually fishing in that area, trawlers coming out of Hyannis. I went on board the boats, I observed the discard, and as a consequence of that, they were fishing close to the beach, right on the beach. And we ended up then with our Marine Fisheries Advisory Commission shutting those waters down from June 1 through June 15. So already there are some closures around in the Nantucket area with these two being the notable ones. Now, for your information, I need to highlight this, that between April 23rd and June 9, this is a state rule, state regulation, between June 23rd and June 9, squid trawlers may use small mesh with the option to extend up to June 15 at the director's discretion. I can extend beyond June 9 if squid are abundant in Massachusetts waters, Nantucket Sound, Vineyard Sound, around the islands. And in my opinion, acting on the advice of my staff, the discards that are occurring are minimal. Again, it's a valuable fishery, so if indeed those conditions are met in our best judgment, then I can extend the season for an additional week. But this is not a whole summer-long fishery. It's restricted to just this time period, all in state waters in the southern part of the state. All right, now, I have to focus on this. I have to give you some history regarding this because, once again, the emphasis has been on Nantucket wants equity Nantucket selectmen have said they want to see the same sorts of closures around Nantucket that exist in other areas of the Commonwealth. These closures in state waters to mobile gear fishing, most of them came about in the 1930s. So they have an interesting history. This is the way it happened, to the best of our understanding. Closures were adopted in Nantucket Sound in 1938 by the legislature after what appears to be a very contentious argument, competition, competing interests of Nantucket and Cape Cod commercial fishermen, especially from Provincetown. Back in the early 20th century, there was a great change in the fisheries in New England. The advent of the gas-powered otter trawl, sizable dragger fleets grew in importance in Massachusetts. There was a dragger fleet in Provincetown and in Nantucket. By 1921, 55 draggers, 35 to 55 feet, worked out of Nantucket, and they fished productive shoal grounds in the eastern portion of the sounds. And then by the 1930s, otter trawls were very numerous, and then fish weir operators out of Nantucket primarily, but elsewhere too, they claimed that their livelihoods were profoundly affected by this mobile gear. So in 1931, the legislature was petitioned by Arthur W. Jones, who was a Nantucket resident and chairman of the House Ways and Means, to prohibit the use of bottom and otter and beam trawls from April through June within the periphery of Nantucket Sound. And that would be from Great Point to Monomoy to Suckanesset Point to Cape Pogue to Eel Point to Great Point, all along the shorelines. And after taking a look at all of the history behind this, presumably, because it's not definite, there's nothing there for us to really read and record, presumably this prohibition was enacted to protect Nantucket interests, especially during the important spring months and perhaps the handline flounder fishing interests. But in 1932, the prohibition was changed to May 1 through October 31st, and now we're speculating that this change came about because it was a target. They were targeted towards mobile gear fishermen catching fluke throughout the summer, and Nantucket draggers were impacted as well. They appreciated the fact that they also were impacted by that closure. Opposition to dragging was increasing, so the broader restriction, that May 1 through October 31st closure, might have been the result. And then, in 1938, several bills were filed, all dealing with seasonal closures to dragging in the Sound. And so we have to assume, this is just an assumption, we have to assume that Nantucket interests were dissatisfied with that summer closure, July through October, preventing the Nantucket draggers from fishing on fluke on nearby grounds. There was a request for a return to a modified spring prohibition, which would be March through May. However, the final bill resulted in the continuation of the May through October closure, okay, the one that I cited in the figure before all the text, a May through October closure except off of Nantucket. Nantucket was only April. And there's no record as to why only April was continued as a dragging closure. So we're assuming that it might have been for continued protection, spawning protection of winter flounder, or maybe a sociological issue, a concern about protecting a large fish weir company on Nantucket's north side. So there may have been possible conflicts between user groups and gear. It wasn't about squid fishing. It wasn't about small mesh fishing. It wasn't about forage. It was all about, back then, it was all about competition between commercial fishing fleets for valuable fishing grounds, fleets out of Nantucket and out of the Cape, notably from Provincetown. So this 1930s fish history reveals concerns and issues that are like the user conflicts that we face today, and not just out of Nantucket, but elsewhere, all throughout the Commonwealth. About 90 years later, now we find ourselves in much of the same debate, but now the emphasis is on squid, on habitat impacts, and on forage, and of course on bycatch. It's important for everyone to understand that the squid fishery occurs up and down the coast by trimester. That's the way we break it down. There's an offshore fishery by larger vessels from January through April, and this shows the distribution of trips landing greater than 2,500 pounds from 2011 through 2014. And you can see that on Georgia's Bank, the southern flank of Georgia's Bank, all the way down towards the Hudson Canyon area and down off of Delaware and New Jersey, almost down to Chesapeake Bay, that's where the majority of the large trips of squid are caught by offshore fishermen, you know, pursuing squid, of course, for the commercial market, domestic as well as foreign. Then, May through August, clearly as the squid move inshore, the fishery moves inshore as well. You can see some still on the shelf, but primarily all along the shores from Massachusetts down through Rhode Island, along Long down Block Island, around Long Island, down towards the upper part of New Jersey. So that's the second trimester, May through August. Then as the waters begin to cool, the squid move offshore, as does the fishing fleet in federal waters. And you see, once again, a similar pattern where the landings are on the southern flank of Georgia's, south of Massachusetts, then down towards the Hudson Canyon area, and then all the way down the shelf towards North Carolina. So it's a squid obviously moves to many places, offshore and inshore, and the commercial fishing fleet will follow them, as one might expect. Just a comparison of 2007 through 2010 versus 2011 through 2014, and it's much the same pattern, an inshore fishing fleet taking advantage of squid as they move inshore where they feed and, of course, you know, where they reproduce. Actions have been taken in federal waters to deal with the squid fishery. These are offshore closures to small mesh fishing implemented by the Mid-Atlantic Council in order to reduce the bycatch of scup. These were implemented quite a few years ago, back I think around 2000, and frankly, they were needed. I played a role in urging that these particular closures be implemented because discard information at that time revealed that a very large amount of small scup were being discarded offshore. There was a need to remove small mesh fishing from these areas, and indeed that's what eventually happened. January 1 through May 15, no small mesh fishing in these areas. And November 1 through December 31st, no small fishing in these areas. This is the Mid-Atlantic Council news release last year in November. So they've just modified, to some extent, these so-called gear-restricted areas. And they did so in order to increase the availability of long-fin squid to small mesh fisheries. Once again, it's a valuable fishery. So they changed the boundaries to afford more opportunities for long-fin squid fishing. I went over that. So in that same news release, it noted that trawl vessels which fish for or possess longfin squid, black sea bass, or silver hake, also known as whiting, are required to use meshes 5 inches or larger in these GRAs during those times of the year. The logic was that the scup stock has expanded. The abundance is very, very high. No overfishing. Overfishing is not occurring. Therefore, concern about bycatch and discard is not as great as it was in years gone by. I'm still concerned about possible discarding. Nevertheless, we have an entirely different resource picture. Back in 2000, the scup resource was in trouble. It was overfished. Overfishing was occurring. There was a need to really keep the pressure off of the small scup. All right, now to Nantucket. I noted before that between April 23rd and June 9, squid trawlers may use small mesh with the option to extend up to June 15 at the director's discretion. And I'll note now that despite indications of a high squid abundance, I did not further extend the 2016 squid season beyond June 16. Clearly, the squid fishery is going to occur again this year, this spring, and we'll be once again looking at information regarding bycatch and discard, availability and abundance of squid relative to whether or not I should extend the fishery for a week. So we'll see what happens in that regard. So these are the tows that I used last year as a way to judge the amount of bycatch and discard. These are tows that were made north of Muskeget Island, just outside this town line, and then down here in state waters, just south of Tuckanut and the western part of Nantucket. These are some of the tows that we looked at regarding what the boats were catching and what was the bycatch and what was being discarded. So 24 observed tows were, we looked at 24 observed tows in June of 2016 to determine if we should extend the small mesh squid fishery in state waters. This is average pounds per tow landed versus discarded for various species caught in smallmouth trawl fishery waters south of Cape Cod. Average landings, and you can see squid on this side. Squid, obviously, the average pounds per tow was high. Why not? They were targeting squid. Squid eggs, striped bass, river herring, black sea bass, scup, obviously, there's a bycatch and discard of scup, horseshoe crabs, fluke, other crabs, and other fin fish. So that's those are the data that we took a look at. This breaks it down in another, in a different way, where we can see in those 24 observed tows, retained species, longfin squid is in the blue, 97% of the total, scup was 2%, 1% was fluke, summer flounder. Underutilized discards, smaller fish. Again, 87% of what was discarded as scup was undersized. And then 10% for butterfish, and then 3% for summer flounder. And then it goes on from there. Now, obviously, bycatch is of importance to me and to my agency. No permit discards. Fishermen have permits for different fisheries, and obviously if they don't have a permit for something, they're going to have to throw it over the side because they can't keep it. So this shows the amount of discards. So Dan?
Yeah, it's not just no permit, but striped bass is listed there, and striped bass can't be landed by that fishery, so it's more regulatory discards. But those are discards.
Yes, they're discards. Okay. Yeah, they are discussed. So, I mean, clearly, I mean, with a small mesh fishery, with a squid fishery, whether it's in state waters or whether it's in federal waters, there will be some discards. There's nowhere to avoid it. But we want to know how much, you know, where is it occurring and how much is occurring. It's of great interest to us. And it's also of great interest to us because we, it's of great interest. And therefore, we're trying to come up with different net designs, working with fishermen that would provide for escapement, that would reduce the amount of bycatch and discards. This is a so-called raised foot rope trawl. It was a conceptual design that we experimented with a few years ago. And you can see here that the scup and the butterfish were out of a grate. They escaped from a grate that was at the top of the net, and flounder and skates and a few other stocks, they did escape. They weren't caught. They went under the foot rope because, again, it's a raised foot rope trawl. So that's one design that we've looked at, and we've also published a lot of our work relative to the different experiments we've done with nets. And again, I'm showing this to you to make the point that we're aware of bycatch and discard, and we're doing everything we can working with fishermen to reduce whatever may be caught and then discarded. It's important to modify nets, and fishermen have given us a lot of ideas as to the sorts of designs we should use to experiment with. This is a published paper in Fisheries Research not too long ago, quantitative analysis of the behavior of longfin infant squid in reaction to species separation grid of an otter trawl. The division staff, Shannon Bay, Spingo Hee, Michael Pohl, and David Chosett. Another publication was by Shannon again, Mike Pohl, and Pingo Hee. Pingo is from SMAST, that's UMass Dartmouth. We work very closely with him on gear modification designs. Here we have fish and squid behavior at the mouth of a drop chain trawl, factors contributing to capture and escape. All right, striped bass. I've got a little bit of information to share with you regarding striped bass because, again, Nantucket Selectmen in the petition and comments afterwards have been along the lines of striped bass abundance is down, fishermen are having trouble, recreational fishermen, they claim, are having trouble catching striped bass, not like in years gone by, and therefore the culprit has been claimed to be the small mesh fishing, squid fishing. Squid is removed by the commercial fishery, therefore there is less squid available, so the claim has been made, and striped bass therefore are not abundant in near shore waters. Well, that's the claim, and it's important for me to help you understand what I've been told by those individuals on my staff and up and down the coast by those researchers who deal with striped bass, who do all the assessments for striped bass. The information that they've looked at, the assessment scientists, reveal that the recreational fisheries information suggests that recreational striped bass landings from waters south of the Cape have decreased since 2008. Recreational bluefish landings actually have increased since 2012. And they have concluded that the most important factor causing the lower catch of striped bass in recent years, and this is really critical, and I'm sure many of you have fished for striped bass, and you still do, and you'll love it, great for the tourism as well. The most important factor is in recent years, lower catch is likely due to the presence of relatively weak year classes produced during 2004 through 2010, resulting in lowered abundance of legal-sized fish. Here are some data that are from the Recreational Fisheries Program regarding total catch and harvest per trip from 2007 through 2015 by Massachusetts County. This is the one of interest here in Nantucket, Dukes and Nantucket counties. Here you can see from 2010 through 2011, 12, 13, 14, and 15, the total catch per trip in the blue line has gone down from a peak around 2008 and 2009, and the harvest per trip has gone down as well in these particular counties. The conclusions of the striped bass assessment, all the scientists involved in this assessment, is that the age 8 and older segment of the population, the greater than 28 inches total length of the coastwide striped bass population, is declining due to low recruitment in Chesapeake Bay, once again, over that time period, 2004 through 2010. The declines in harvest rates have been anticipated along the coast, and harvest in most states has, in fact, declined since 2013. Harvest declines are not due to decreased effort because harvest per trip has declined as well. This shows the abundance of age one and older fish from 1982 all the way through 2016. Age one plus fish remain relatively stable over all those years. But what's important to note is that for age eight and older fish, there's been a steady decline, gradual, but nevertheless a steady decline from about 2002 down to 2015. And the projection is it will continue to decline in 2017. More conclusions. Harvest rates are likely to increase as the 2011 year class becomes more vulnerable to the fishery. So that's good news. There is a 2011 year class out there that shows promise. It's going to become vulnerable to the fishery. Total catch rates, mostly due to small fish that are released, are increasing as the 2011 year class becomes more vulnerable to fishing. However, as noted by the assessment scientists, the harvest rates will not increase greatly because older year classes and the 2012 to 14 year classes are well below the average. The decline in harvest rate was observed in most counties since 2013, but the decline started earlier, 2009, in Dukes and Nantucket counties. And total catch rates appear to be increasing in most counties north of Cape Cod, indicating higher availability of smaller fish. So based on the Massachusetts commercial fishery data, the data that we look at, that my staff looks at, there was an apparent striped bass shift in 2015 to Cape Cod Bay. And so we're speculating that this could have impacted the catch rates in the Nantucket area. The fish just shifted to a different area. Also, striped bass, they do not eat squid, but whether the removal of squid by the fishery is impacting the distribution of striped bass is unknown, and I should highlight that. And that brings me to the next topic, spawning squid. Did I say that? I apologize. I read it wrong. Speaking too much. Striped bass do eat squid, obviously. But whether the removal of the squid by the fishery is impacting the distribution of striped bass is unknown. And that, of course, is the uncertainty that we all have to wrestle with. What indeed is the impact of less squid on striped bass availability? All right, let's get to spawning squid and squid mops. Again, this was another point made by the town of Nantucket, the selectmen, that mobile gear fishing is impacting the squid mops, those gelatinous fingers that have all the squid eggs that are laid by the squid in the spring. And actually, they spawn at more times than the spring, but that's where the peak is. All right, so the question is, do spawning squid and squid mops need more protection from impacts due to bottom trawling? A question, is there reduced survival of squid eggs due to squid mops being caught and discarded? Importantly, this was identified as an information gap during a recent meeting of the Mid-Atlantic Fishery Management Council. They delved into this. It's on their agenda. What about spawning squid? How do you go about protecting spawning squid specifically? What about the squid mops? What's the importance of those mops? If they're dislodged from the ocean bottom where they're attached by the squid, do they not hatch out? NIMS scientists, National Marine Fishery scientists, have indicated that squid mops are more susceptible to temperature and food, that is plankton availability. And this is all in published research, such as this research published a few years ago, 1998 actually, by Roger Hanlon, Malcolm Smal, and Warwick Sawyer. This is the mating system of squid off South Africa. So the idea here is that if you have squid off of South Africa fighting, guarding, sneaking, mating, and egg laying, it's likely that the squid in Massachusetts and elsewhere will exhibit the same sort of behavior. So this research is applicable to our area in better understanding how squid reproduce. Another one by Emma Hatfield and Steve Cadron, geographic and temporal patterns and size and maturity of the longfin inshore squid fishery off of northeastern United States. A lot of work has been done on squid. A lot of publications exist. But still, despite all of that work, those publications, there is uncertainty about the impact of dislodging squid mops in terms of whether the eggs will actually hatch out and the young will survive. So back to the question again. Do spawning squid and squid mops need more protection from the impacts due to bottom trawling? Well, squid mops and the potential for interactions with mobile gear can occur in all areas and season where and when squid spawn, including in both state and federal waters throughout the coast and offshore. Division of Marine Fishery scientists have documented the distribution of squid mops throughout state waters from Buzzards Bay to Ipswich Bay based on recent Division of Marine Fisheries surveys. To fully mitigate impacts of mobile gear on squid mops, if warranted, and this is an important point, if warranted, restrictions well beyond waters around Nantucket would be required, including federal waters. Once again, squid just don't spawn off of Nantucket or Martha's Vineyard. They spawn all up and down the coast. So if indeed there's an impact, then there should be consideration of restrictions in many other areas, not just Massachusetts, state waters, or federal waters. In Massachusetts, potential bottom trawl interactions with squid mops and spawning aggregations are somewhat constrained by many other factors, including other existing rules in Massachusetts, and many of these rules through Division of Marine Fisheries regulations in recent years. Although the net banning in all of Buzzards Bay, that was a legislative action back in the, I think, in the 1800s. So different fishing practices, regulatory closures by the Division of Marine Fisheries with our commission, the presence of fixed gear and untowable area all have an impact on mobile gear fishing and reducing the areas and the times when mobile gear fishing actually can occur in our waters when squid are available or not. This shows the areas where squid spawn, indicated by catches of eggs by squid mops and commercial trawls. And you can see that the areas where spawning occurs is all the way from the Massachusetts area, southeast of Massachusetts, around the islands. This is May and July, all the way down to the Long Island Sound on the southern shore of Long Island, down to off of New Jersey. So it's a very, very expansive area for reproduction. There's actually perhaps some reproduction that occurs out here on George's Bank and maybe offshore March through April. This is June through August. All right. Despite years of fishing pressure, longfin squid are not overfished. That's important for everyone to understand. It's not overfished. An assessment update is scheduled for 2017. Overall, so we understand from the assessment scientists, the species is considered lightly exploited, with less than 50% of the quota being harvested in 2009, with annual landings being stable at around 12,000 metric tons. And our own Division of Marine Fisheries surveys of state waters using a bottom trawl, it's our 1978 until the current time survey, it has showed expanded distribution within the survey area in recent years and increasing numbers per tow in the spring and weight per tow in the fall since 2010. So this is all very positive in terms of squid and spawning inside state waters, never mind federal waters. But still, it's important for me to state that the relationship between squid mops, reproductive success, and stock status for this very short-lived species that live a little more than a year, that's all. It's rather surprising, but a little more than a year, it's unknown. Conclusions, these are the conclusions that I have drawn based upon everything that I've told you, talking with my staff and other people. Spawning squid and squid mops do not need protection from impacts due to bottom trawling in those waters around Nantucket, Tuckanuck, and Muskeget Islands. Obviously, not everyone agrees with that conclusion. I thought I would show this to you because a very notable and prestigious organization has weighed in on this particular issue, weighed in with the Mid-Atlantic Fishery Management Council and certainly with the Division of Marine Fisheries. This is on the website of Pew Charitable Trusts. They have indicated in a recent release, news release, Northeast squid deserve a summer break. This was published in March of this year. Officials should act to stem heavy fishing on this key forage species in its spawning grounds. And then they go on to say, Atlantic longfin squid like these gather every summer to spawn in the waters off Nantucket and Martha's Vineyard. Tighter commercial fishing management for this forage species is needed for the benefit of squid, ocean predators, and other fishermen. So, again, they've weighed in. Nevertheless, here are some conclusions, once again, that I've drawn with the assistance of my staff and others. Mm-hmm. Smallmouth fishing, obviously, is an anathema, a curse to some, even though smallmouth fishing is necessary to catch the very valuable squid for local and distant markets. There's no getting away from that. It's a valuable species. Smallmouth fishing has to occur. So I acknowledge, absolutely, from my looking at bycatch and discard information, from my looking at the literature, and from my own understanding of squid, it's a very high value, it has high value because it is a prey for important recreational species. No doubt about that, and thank goodness it is. So therein lies the problem that my advisory commission Ray Kane chairs, the problem that I share, the division shares with the commission, it's a complicated predator-prey interaction which no one completely understands or can accurately assess. We only have conjecture and opinions, informed or otherwise. Now, this is something that needs to be understood by all. The National Marine Fisheries Service has adopted the Mid-Atlantic Council Fishery Management Plan for squid in federal waters. There is the trimester approach. There are specific quotas for the commercial fishery in trimester 1, 2, and 3. The National Marine Fisheries Service allows a rollover of the squid quota from trimester 1 to trimester 2. So if they don't take the quota in trimester 1 offshore, it spills over, it rolls over into trimester 2. So that has done in recent years something of significance. It's resulted, in all likelihood, with increased fishing effort inshore. Although, and this is again to be highlighted, although not in state waters. And it hasn't occurred in state waters because of our seasonal state water closures. But it does occur in federal waters south of the islands. And those fishing vessels fishing in federal waters south of the island for quite a long time, because they can, it is allowed, it's attracted the attention, obviously, of Nantucket residents. So I understand. Pete's made that very clear to me. Other individuals have made that very clear to me. It's understandable because the fleet is seen fishing out of state waters over that long time period, taking advantage of the rollover of squid and also the fact that the bycatch limit of squid when the directed fishery closes is 2,500 pounds in federal waters. And that actually allows for a directed fishery on squid because squid is profitable. It's a small-scale directed fishery. So once again, that has attracted a lot of effort south of the islands and, of course, has justifiably so made the selectmen of Nantucket call attention to it and state waters fishing by virtue of the petition that they've offered up. Nevertheless, it's unlikely that there have been increased impacts to squid inshore spawning habitat, although we wait further for council discussions on this issue. The Mid-Atlantic Council, once again, is focused on squid spawning on habitat and what additional things need to be done to protect that habitat. Oh, you took away my presentation. I can't advance it. Okay. Gonna have to hang up on them. Okay. Okay. Habitat protection. That's another issue. Once again, brought to my attention the mobile gear fishing in Nantucket waters, in-state waters, south of the islands, around the islands, has had an impact on the habitat. And it's been called to my attention, and I understand this because I was involved in these decisions. Right now, there is area to be closed, likely, by the National Marine Fisheries Service, acting on a plan by the New England Fishery Management Council to close down large areas of offshore waters to mobile gear fishing in order to protect the ocean bottom, okay? Hard bottom, notably. This is the Great South Channel, Southern New England Habitat Management Area Alternative 4. This, in all likelihood, is what's going to be closed down once the National, to mobile gear fishing, once the National Marine Fisheries Service finishes its review and then implements the regulations that would create this closure. So a large area, Nantucket Shoals primarily. It does not go up against state waters line. It's there's a gap right here, a little bit bigger, so you can see it a little better. So this is what will be closed down to mobile gear fishing with a one-year surf clam dredge exemption. So we await that final decision by the National Marine Fisheries Service. And that decision was made as a basis of, as a consequence of, a look-see at these data provided by individuals who have a clear understanding of the bottom contours, the substrate in many areas off of New England. I'll just focus on one of these figures, and that's the one. You can see in green that this is mud silt, and then sand, granule pebble, about the size of my thumbnail, cobble, like cobbles you'd find on the streets of Nantucket, and then the large boulders. So the red is boulder, and the orange is cobble. So the reason why this area is going to be closed in all likelihood to mobile gear fishing with that one-year exemption for surf clam fishing is concerned that indeed this is boulder and cobble, so it needs to be off limits for mobile gear fishing. There's no closure here to the west of this boundary, and certainly this area is not being closed. It's state waters. It's not part of any consideration for federal fisheries management, federal fisheries action. All right. Other impacts on fish off Nantucket. I'll bring this to a close shortly. Other fisheries, well, this is what was proposed by the Mid-Atlantic Council that they were going to put in place through the amendment to their squid plan that's in development. They were going to close these areas to mobile gear fishing to protect spawning squid, Area 1 and Area 2, outside of state waters, actually. That's what they were going to do. They focused only on this area off of Massachusetts. They did not focus any place else, which I found rather amazing considering the squid spawn in all those other areas. The focus was just here. And I think it's largely because of the initiative of Pete Kaiser. To your credit, Pete. To your credit and testimony. This is not criticism. I give you credit for your enthusiasm for the way you have come to the way you have pushed for attention to be brought to Nantucket's concerns. So again, it's not criticism. It's just an acknowledgement of all the good work you've done. And then, the Lolago squid effort in trimester two, once again, to highlight why in the particular, these areas were being considered for closure due to Mid-Atlantic Council action, Area 1, Area 2. You can see here that Area 1 is in the red. I'll just focus on this trimester 2, May through August, 2006, 8, 10, 12, 14, and 16. You know, effort has gone up in that Area 2, Area 1, okay, in recent years, landings and thousands of metric tons. It's gone up from around, 1,000 metric tons up to around 3,000 metric tons in Area 1. And once again, that's Area 1 in the green. So effort has intensified south of the islands in recent years as a consequence of abundance of squid, clearly, and the value of that squid. I'll just pass by that. Squid is predators. All right. Everyone tends to forget this, and I'll never forget it because I'm involved in many so-called ecosystem-based fisheries management initiatives, and the initiative involves looking at predators. What's the prey? What are the predators? We always tend to forget that squid are predators. Squid eat fish. Here are a couple of shots that demonstrate the predation. This is a different squid, but you can see that it's eating a tuna. And this is a smaller squid eating a shrimp. Shrimp is an important part of the diet of squid, as is fish. They're also cannibalistic, And here's another shot of a squid consuming a fish. So squid are very important predators of fish, especially juvenile fish. So when you have tremendous numbers of squid in any particular area, if they're spawning, they're spawning, but they can also be eating and consuming because they are key predators in the ecosystem. Here are two papers that were published not too long ago, 2006, Size Structured Patterns of Piscifery of the Longfin Squid in the Mid-Atlantic Continental Shelf Ecosystem, and Evaluating the Potential for Trophodynamic Control of Fish by the Squid in the Northwest Atlantic Ocean, published in the Canadian Journal of Fisheries and Aquatic Sciences. Then they noted as part of their conclusions that squid consume high quantities of prey on daily and seasonal timescales. Comparisons between estimates of population consumption and fish recruitment biomass indicate that Lolago, and here's an important conclusion, may potentially exert so-called trophodynamic control of recruitment success of commercially exploited fish species, even if these species are only a minor prey item of squid. Predation interactions of Lolago squid should be considered, they advise, when managing and rebuilding fish stocks in the Northwest Atlantic continental ecosystem. Average estimates of individual consumption were 12% and 8% of squid body mass per day, with average estimates being 300 metric tons and 200 metric tons of fish consumed by squid per day for the summer and winter seasons, respectively. The largest squid, 9 to 31 centimeters on the mantle length, minimum estimate of consumption of juvenile fish, and this is rather astounding, 306,000 metric tons. And 189,000 metric tons for summer and winter season, respectively. So they're major predators. It's a significant source of pre-recruit mortality on fish and may serve as a potential constraint on the recruitment success of commercially targeted fish, especially during years of high squid abundance. That's a conclusion that those researchers drew. So as generalist predators, because they eat all sorts of things, crustaceans as well as fish, it is likely that squid prey on multiple fish species, and the strength of their predatory impact will depend on the degree of spatial and temporal overlap between squid and their prey. All right. What else? What else has an impact on fish in this particular area? I came to Nantucket a few months ago to attend a seal symposium. It was fascinating. I learned a lot from that seal symposium. Here is the gray seal, and you can see that they do consume a number of species. They consume cod, obviously sea herring, and striped bass. Waiting and watching, they're everywhere in great numbers. I don't have to tell you that, residents of Nantucket, especially because certain areas have been closed to recreational fishermen because of the presence of gray seals on the beach. Help minimize disturbance, area closed to protect the seals. And this is the symposium I went to based upon the, came about because of concern by Crocker Snow. Muskeget, Raw, Restless, Relentless Land, he published that book called Muskeget, describing what he knows about Muskeget and the presence of gray seals on that island. There's Muskeget Island, as you well know. They're very abundant on Muskeget and elsewhere, certainly on Monomoy Island. The numbers are phenomenal. And, of course, they've attracted white sharks to our waters as well. This shows a home range and offshore forays of a tag gray seal. I thought I'd show it to you because it shows how these seals move around. These are some tracks of seals. One was tagged here off of Truro. It went all the way to George's Bank, dove down to 265 meters. It was, of course, tagged with acoustically, and then while it went all the way about into the Gulf of Maine and back down to Provincetown, North Truro. There was one tagged off Monomoy Island and went to Nantucket Shoals and zigged and zagged all over the place and eventually went back to the Nantucket area. All right. So that's a long presentation, but I needed to give you what we know and to give you the foundation, the background for why I made the decision that it was inappropriate for me to embrace the petition and to move it forward as a recommendation to my Marine Fisheries Advisory Commission that indeed they should support a closure of all the waters around Nantucket to mobile gear fishing. So with that said, I'll turn to the selectmen and ask if you have any remarks you would like to make.
Thank you, Dr. Pierce. Thank you for coming. everyone in the audience. I'd especially like to point out the dragger guys from the Cape. I know how hard it is to come over here, so Eddie, you guys, thank you for coming. Nantucket has a rich fishing history from the whaling days to present. Over the years, the industry has changed. Due to overfishing and regulation changes, we no longer have an active commercial fleet based out of Nantucket. Only two draggers call Nantucket their home port. However, because there is no commercial ice house or fuel dock, they fish the waters outside Nantucket and offload most of their catch in other ports like New Bedford and Hyannis. The commercial rod and reel fishery has been put out of business by regulations and overfishing. There are no more codfish that come close to the island like in the 60s and 70s. The shore-based commercial fisherman is only allowed to sell two striped bass per day and only for a small period of time. The commercial sea bass and fluke fishery are closed so that no one can obtain the necessary permits. Our commercial fishermen have turned to guiding, shore guiding, and charter fishing during the summer, spring, and fall, and bay scalloping during the winter months. Shore-based sport fishing, guiding, and charter fishing is an important part of our local economy. People from all over the world come to fish the waters and shores around Nantucket. The Ripon Beach at Great Point is a world-famous destination for striped bass, bluefish, bonita, and false albacore fishing. The town and county of Nantucket has made every effort to enhance the quality of the waters and shores around Nantucket. Nantucket was one of the first towns in the Commonwealth to pass a no-discharge zone and strict fertilizer regulations. Recently, the town approved a multi-million dollar sewer project to reduce the amount of nitrogen discharged into Nantucket Harbor. Over the past several years, we have seen depletion in the forage fish around Nantucket. The once abundant schools of herring, butterfish, and now squid have disappeared. The decline has resulted in a decrease in the amount of shore-based fish caught by recreational anglers and charter guides. During that same time, we've seen an increase in the amount of otter trawl fishing for squid and herring in the waters around Nantucket. In the technical report that you showed us earlier, Dr. Pierce, that you and Dan wrote in 1995, in the executive summary, I'm going to read a quote. Squid is in danger of being overfished region-wide. Each year, the spawning stocks consist of only one cohort supporting inshore and offshore fisheries. That report was written in 1995. It's now 2017, and nothing has changed. If anything, there is even more pressure than now. At present, there are 202 boats with coastal access permits, of which 140 hold squid endorsements. The majority are either out-of-state boats or from other ports other than Nantucket, ports that have the protection of a closure in state waters from May 1 to October 31st. It has been said that there is no science to back up this closure, that there are other factors that have caused the decline in fish stocks over the last 20 years. It's a sad day when we accept the outcome of poor management by necessity, of management by necessity instead of management by caution. Imagine how bad the state of the near-water fishery will be if we continue along this path of the status quo for the next 20 years. Small mesh fishing is the market gunning of the 21st century. The damage done to the Bottoms Bethel community and spawning areas are untold. We've been told that this is a clean fishery, and in the other document that you quoted in your presentation, I wanted to take you to Table 18 that talks about bycatch. It says on this table that for every 100 pounds of long-fin squid retained, there is 56.5 pounds of discarded species. That's for every 100 pounds. In 2016, in trimester two, there were 19 million pounds of squid taken in trimester two. Using these figures, that equals 10,735,000 pounds of bycatch. That's a lot of bycatch. It's unacceptable. If you go to table 16 in that document, which is 2013 to 2015, data from trips greater than 40% longfin annual, substantial discard species, alewives, 35,749 pounds, squid eggs, 22,204 pounds. These are from the observed trips. That's based on the annual discards based on the 26 million pounds of squid landed. Meanwhile, the recreational fisherman is not allowed to take one river heron, not one. And our fluke and sea bass quotas for rod and reel fishing are going to be cut again. For years, Nantucket has stood by and watched the waters around our island be heavily fished, with no voice in the process. Well, not anymore. We are asking for the same protection that the majority of the coastal towns in the state have. It has been said that this will affect the fluke and conch draggers that fish north of Tuckernut. However, there is no longer a byboat that comes to the island to offload fluke. The fleet fishes the other side of the sound or outside the 3-mile line. We want the ability to enhance the nearshore fisheries around Nantucket, not destroy them. We want to see the amount of fish around the island increase, not decrease. Once the protection is in place, we plan to start the permitting process to install artificial reefs and fish habitat all around the island. It is our understanding that this will go before the Marine Fisheries Commission for a vote. We have been told that one member of the commission stated that there was that we were nothing but a bunch of rich elitists. Nothing could be further from the truth. We are working class people who happen to live in a town where elitists vacation. Thank you for this opportunity. We look forward to working with the commission to resolve this issue.
Okay, thank you. And Senator Sears, a representative, would you care to make a statement?
Yes, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Tom Dixon, legislative liaison for State Representative Dylan Fernandez.
And I'm Pat Johnson, Chief of Staff to State Senator Julian Sear, represents Nantucket, Martha's Vineyard, and the Cape. And thank you, Dr. Pierce, Mr. McKiernan, and Mr. Kane for letting us speak here. On behalf of Senator Sear and Rep. Fernandez, who co-wrote a letter that they asked us to read here today.
Regarding Nantucket Mobile Gear Petition, dear Dr. Pierce, thank you for traveling to Nantucket for this rescheduled public hearing today. The Mobile Gear Petition you are hearing public comment is deeply important to us and the Nantucket community, and we would be at the hearing today in person if we were not in session at the State House. We appreciate that you have held off final consideration of this petition after today's rescheduled meeting. As you and your staff are well aware, commercial, charter, and sport fishermen are a critical part of our year-round community in Nantucket, Martha's Vineyard, and Cape Cod. Our fishing families sustain our communities, not just in the summer, but year-round, as they have done for generations. This long-term preservation of the fishing industry, including sport fishing, is in our region is critical. As new legislators, we have embraced the roles that our predecessors and those before them held to protect the small boat fishery that makes our region's fleet unique. The Cape and Islands do not have the large corporate-owned fleets of other ports in Massachusetts. Our boats are family-owned and financed. We take seriously the importance of the regulations that affect their livelihood. The Cape and Islands fishery is balanced between commercial day and charter boats. Some interest in the large corporate ports in Massachusetts have dismissed the concerns we raised today, saying the concerns are overblown and the constituents we represent are a privileged few. But if you take a closer look, this assertion is false. Residents on Nantucket face serious challenges. Making it year-round on Nantucket is not easy with the high cost of housing and living balanced against stagnant or declining wages and limited services on island.
Tourism is critical to our economy on Nantucket, Martha's Vineyard, and Cape Cod, and to the Commonwealth as a whole. Tourism to the Cape and Islands is an engine of tax revenue for the Commonwealth, generating millions of dollars to the general fund every year. Charter fishing is a tremendous draw for tourists in Nantucket, particularly during the shoulder months when other tourists do not visit. The extension of the tourist season on Nantucket into the fall and spring is key, and charter fishing is among our main attractions. Given this, fishing regulations must balance both the interests of the Commonwealth's commercial fishing fleet with the interests of tourism and our fleet of charter boats. This proposal simply gives Nantucket the same protections that 63 of 70 coastal communities in Massachusetts are already afforded, the ability to protect and steward the habitat off their coastline. Protection of squid, herring, and other bait fish are essential to the long-term viability of all fishing off of Nantucket. These species are also vital to the island's inshore ecosystem. Continued use of mobile gear and small mesh nets off of Nantucket has the potential to continue to deplete the Nantucket fishery. In the past 2 years, significant amounts of squid over quota were allowed to be caught by commercial dragging vessels. Last summer, 19 million pounds of squid were caught in the Nantucket fishery, over twice the quota limit of 8 million pounds. This high level of catch over quota merits further study by DMF. Constituents of ours who have been fishing these waters for decades are testifying today and have raised serious concerns about the depletion of squid off of Nantucket, the level of bycatch by boats using mobile gear, and the financial impact commercial boats using mobile gear so close to Nantucket shores have on our charter boat industry. Please do not dismiss these real concerns. We ask you to support the proposal for a mobile gear closure off of Nantucket. This closure would provide consistent protection and control for the Nantucket fishing community that most coastal communities in Massachusetts enjoy. As you are likely aware, we have filed legislation this session to mandate these protections if DMF will not act. We would prefer to see this matter adopted through DMF's regulatory process, but are mindful that significant provisions of the Commonwealth's fishery rules and regulation have been enacted by the legislature. We thank you for your consideration and again appreciate your efforts to hold this hearing on Nantucket, signed jointly by State Senator Julian Sear and State Representative Dylan Fernandez.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen. Appreciate that. So you've made available those comments, correct?
I have copies here.
Okay, good. All right, thank you. Thank you. Now, I was given a list of individuals who would like to speak. Obviously, many would. This is a...
I think Roger Hammond is waiting to possibly...
Okay. Do you know how long he's going to talk, Pete?
10 to 15 minutes, maybe.
Okay, this... So, Rod...
We've got a little bit of a time schedule.
Yeah, we've got a time schedule, so... Hold on for a second. I'll tell you what. Hold on a second, Ed. Please. Let's hold on. I want to give these guys an opportunity to speak before we patch them in, and that way they can make a ferry if need be. So they've come all the way from the mainland. Okay. So appreciate that, Pete. It's a good reminder. So what I'm going to do is go through. Actually, I'm going to go through this list, but I'm going to alternate. I'm going to pick one off the list and offer up an opportunity for someone else to speak, and then I'm going to go to the second part of the list because probably many individuals have not been made aware of this list that was given to me. So let's do it that way. We'll start with Jeff Carlson. And Jeff, if you will, speak into the microphone. You don't need to come down to the microphone as long as you speak loudly because I think the acoustics are pretty good in here.
We're recording it, so if people could come to the microphone, it would be appreciated.
Since you're recording it, then please go to the mic. Go ahead.
Good afternoon. My name is Jeff Carlson. I'm the Natural Resources Coordinator for the town of Nantucket through our Natural Resources Department. Again, thank you guys for coming down today and rescheduling. And I know we're under the gun for weather again, so I won't take a long time. But I wanted to illustrate some points and have a little bit of discussion about some of the issues that have been raised to this point. And some of the questions that I get in our office and that I want to kind of pass along. And really what we're looking at and some of the major questions that I hear are how do we bridge these information gaps that we have? How do we make the best decisions about this fishery that we can and answer more of these questions that we have? How can we evaluate, the impacts of continual dragging on the area south of the island and what's that doing to the benthic habitat? How does one dragger interact with it? And then more coming through, what's the cumulative impact to these habitats over time, and what's the cumulative impact to the species that use these areas that we're looking at. That being said, I won't go over a lot of the things that Selectman DaCosta said, but we also have significant concerns about the amount of bycatch that's coming in and the cumulative impacts about that as well as it relates to the south shore of our island and continuing around the eastern shore. Nantucket spends an inordinate amount of time managing these impacts, whether it's through the Conservation Commission and managing our coastal erosion structures and managing nourishment volumes and the amount of sand that's put into our nearshore area, managing our nutrient inputs into our water for bay scallop and shellfishing fisheries. All we're asking is that before decisions are made about the habitats around Nantucket, that the research is done and the research is complete. And until that's the case, we ask that those areas be protected until we know that the impacts are going to be greater than negligible and that the cumulative impacts aren't going to be degrading our habitats and our resources over time. And that's really what we're looking for, and we would really entertain the opportunity to aid in that and participate and be an active participant with the Division of Marine Fisheries to answer these questions that we need to help the Mid-Atlantic Fishery Council and the New England Fishery Council to get these questions answered so we're making the best decisions that we can about the fishery and the best decisions that we can about the methods used for fishing. And I really appreciated today seeing that there's been a lot of work on net design and refining that method, but I really think it's time for us to, you know, update our 1995 reports and really put an effort to developing the best management practices for fishing in this area to diminish the impacts that we're having so we can still have a commercially viable fishery without having the impacts that are associated with current practices. And thank you again for coming, and I'll hand it off to whoever's next.
Thank you. Can I have a show of hands of who would like to speak? Okay, good. All right, so I'm going to recognize someone who's not on the list, but someone in the audience, and then I'll get back to the list. So who would like to speak? Yes. Steve.
My name's Steve Welch, commercial fisherman for 38 years. My grandfather used to fish down here in the Sound in the 40s. I actually have in a bag there some of the wooden roller gear he used to make in the winter. I have as much interest in keeping the Sound healthy as everybody in this room. I've been villainized. Commercial fishermen have been villainized for a number of years by the press and observations by people on people who aren't good fishermen. All right, and I didn't want to do this. I'll take a little bit of time. I'm going to read my resume and let you know how I feel it's important for fishermen to take an active role in being proactive for the resource and the management and of the fisheries. I'm not a good speaker. I'm nervous. I'm a fisherman, but I'll give it a try. I graduated from Cape Cod Community College. I hold a 100-ton license from the Mass Maritime Academy. I'm a certified vessel safety instructor from Mass Maritime Academy, completed the Marine Resource Education Program, hold a license in species safe handling, release, and identification. I was a former member of the Federal Advisory Commission Marine Protected Areas. They pick one fisherman throughout the country. I was picked for that because of my role in responsible fishing practices I've been pushing for a number of years. A former member of the Board of Directors of Northeast Seafood Coalition. I'm the Vice President of the Northeast Fishery Sector 10. Moderator for the Gulf of Marine Research Institute Marine Management Program. Former Fisheries Liaison for the Northeast Fishery Observer Program. I was a former groundfish advisor, monkfish advisor, and essential fish habitat advisor for the National Marine Fisheries Service, and I've worked with the Division of Marine Fisheries as a representative for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts and fishing. I can't even read this. I'm shaking so much. The DMS, a representative of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts for Fishing Gear Advisory Workshop, and I was invited as a U.S. guest speaker for this Fendercod workshop, supported by the European Commission to promote good, responsible fishing practices. I'm a member and speaker for the North Atlantic Responsible Fishing Conference. I've done numerous cooperative research projects for monkfish, groundfish, gear selectivity, marine mammal entanglements. I've done numerous research work. Currently, I'm working with Woods Hole for real-time data on water temperature, water quality, air, and real-time vessel monitoring reporting. So every time I haul back, that information is sent immediately to Woods Hole, so they have a real-time picture of what's going on. It's a great program. It's up and coming, and I think it's done a lot for the industry so far. I do this because I've seen a huge change in fishing. I started on the Miss Kim down here in 1981 fishing Nantucket Sound. Since went offshore and gillnetted, and I brought the gillnets home with me, that's how I was picked up and responsible. I never left my gillnets out by themselves. I always brought them home with me. I came a dragoman, and now through federal regulations, I've been pigeonholed into like making 87% of my yearly income comes from Nantucket Sound. I fish a lot just north of Tuckanuck and just south of Tuckanuck. In June, we have big mesh. We don't catch that small squid. I heard what was going on south of the island by those boats. I saw those boats out there. And I just don't want people to look at me and the other fishermen, the small boat fishermen in this area that need the sound, May, June, July, August, September. It's going to be there's a really good conch fishery right outside the island. You must see us, you know, when you go on the ferry back and forth, the small boats working there. The reason with the buy boats is, I guess Mark didn't want to do it, and, you know, I'd like to come over here. The thing is, I'm paying $12,000 a year to tie up in Hyannis. This is the last year I'm going to pay that. We have gentrification going on all over the place. Nantucket is an extremely important part of my fishery in Nantucket Sound is. I really feel for you guys. I've been through it. I'm from Scituate. I saw what happened. They went from good fishing programs and to switch to catch shares where the whole fleet moved in and wiped out the codfish stock off of Scituate. I saw that back in 2010, 11, and 12. We complained to the council. Nothing got done. Money's taken over the fishery. I don't know what the answer is, but please, you know, I'd like to have dialogue. I don't know any of you guys, but except my buddy, but there's, I need this fishery. I got a wife, I got started late in life, I got a wife, I got two young kids at home, I have to put through school, put food on the table, it's very important to me. I was a person, and this is what commercial fishing has done. I saw that you did that thing, the veterans, and you take them on your boat. My father was 100% disabled from the Korean War. He was brutal growing up, mentally, physically. The only thing that saved me from going to jail was commercial fishing. I got a job on the boat. They took me offshore. I straightened myself out. I wasn't allowed to go in the Marine Corps. I have two broken discs in my back from growing up. So commercial fishing saved my life. It provides my family, and there's many people and young kids back here that should have that opportunity, and we're losing it. By shutting more and more people out of the fishery isn't going to solve a problem. So we need to work together and fix this problem. But please don't, you know, south of the island, I really don't care about. North of the island is where I make all my money. Thanks.
Okay, is that Cam Granule or Granule? Okay.
Thank you guys for coming over. Just left the room, but it was a nice testimony. I'm Cam Gamble. I live here on Nantucket, and I'm the owner of three businesses here. I own Bill Fisher Tackle, Nantucket's oldest tackle shop, Bill Fisher Outfitters, a charter company out of Mattiket, and Fisher Real Estate. Fishing touches almost every resident or visitor on Nantucket, either directly or indirectly, and it's the underlying fabric of Nantucket and the origins of our community. I was a little disappointed, and most of your presentation was fantastic. I was a little disappointed in seeing the increase of squid right off of here that you pointed out in a chart, and the decrease in striped bass, and that you couldn't come to a conclusion that striped bass were affected by squid, or at least keep it open to a potential conclusion. I was also disappointed to see that you put in these waters that blue fishing has increased. Anyone who spends any time on the water has seen blue fishing decrease over the last 3 years. I can show it to you statistically. I know it's not scientific, but through sales of bluefish plugs in the tackle shop. The conversation we're having today seems to be rooted in economics, not in environmental impacts of the fishery, which is too bad. As the gentleman just said, money has overtaken this fishery. I say this because if we were focused on the environmental impact, we would see that catching 57 pounds per 100 pounds of squid shouldn't happen. It's outrageous, especially last year when the bycatch accounted for 10 million pounds. As stated by Mr. DaCosta before. Further, we're talking about a species that you just blatantly said is in an area of reproducing. So since it's my opinion that a lot of this is based on some economic parameters, I'm here to speak upon the economic and socioeconomic impact of the fishery on Nantucket. Sustainable Nantucket did a study and found that every dollar spent on Nantucket is going to be spent 7 more times on Nantucket. This means if you buy something in my tackle shop, I'm going to go spend it on a cup of coffee. Guy who owns the coffee shop is going to spend it on flowers. Might go over to Island Lumber. That's interesting. It's amazing how this small community, 30 miles out to sea, the money stays here. Every dollar has way more impact here than it might in other areas where Starbucks might take it to a corporate chain, where Walmart might take it somewhere else. We are directly impacted by every dollar, in my opinion, more than other spots. It's the multiplier effect. Specifically to Bill Fisher Tackle, we're one of two tackle shops on island. Just 5 years ago, there were four tackle shops. We continue to have a nice business, but it's clear that there's a decline in our fishery, and the numbers say it. It's very simple. Fish need bait to sustain themselves, and our bait has declined significantly. Not only are stripers way down, bluefish are declining steadily, and even inshore squidding, which people used to do on the docks readily, has declined significantly. Our squid jig sales are way down. More than that, people can attest to, do you take your kids down there every night like you used to? You just don't. We don't have squid right in the harbor like we used to.
Please, let's respect the speaker. There's no need to comment on whatever remarks are made. Let's respect every speaker's perspective. Go ahead.
Specifically, I could show you our numbers with respect to our June sales, which are directly affected by the striped bass fishery, specifically on the beach. Those sales continue to be off year after year, and it's as simple as our bass fishery has declined, as you pointed out too. As I also mentioned, I own a real estate company. This is important because I've seen tourism dollars fade away. There's a little village out on the east side of the island, Crow's Nest, a group of seven houses that guys used to come and rent for the month of June and September. There's a big group of Jersey guys who came and spent money at the Downey Flake, at the Tackle Shop, at Hatches. Those Jersey guys aren't coming to the island anymore. They're not renting those houses anymore. If we take the multiplier effect of what they used to spend here, and I'm talking about one subset of tourism, I'm not talking about other groups who no longer come here because our fishery has declined. That money has a meaningful impact on our overall community, both at the tackle shop, the real estate company, the coffee shop. You can go down the list with the multipliers. These are just a couple of examples from my small corner of Nantucket. I implore you to think about the economic impacts that are declining in our fishery. However it may be caused, I'm taking an opinion that bait has something to do with it, affects us. I don't know what can be changed in the short term. I'm hoping this gets considered. I do know you have direct control on June 9th to make a decision there as well. So just know it affects my family and a lot of others around here. Thank you.
Who else would like to speak? Eddie.
Good afternoon, everybody here. Some of you might know me. I've been fishing around Nantucket for about the last 20 years. I own a small boat dragger. It's the Sirius. When I'm at this meeting, I have to go back to Dragnet. And I like to say, as Joe Friday would say, just the facts, ma'am. Because what we're here to do is hear a petition about state waters for 6 months. We're not trying to fix the ecological harm that is happening everywhere. It's happening in the South Shore of Massachusetts. It's happening in Outer Cape. It's happening here. We have habitat degradation. How many people in here can't say that Nantucket is less fruitful marine-wise because of the number of houses, development, fertilizer, nitrogen runoff? I'll tell you, in the last 3 years, I have not fished that much off of Nantucket because of the presence of weed. The weed that's fouling my 6-inch net, not the small mesh squid net. So we have a lot of problems, but they're not caused by the small amount of drags that you actually have. When we talk about numbers of draggers, Robert pointed out that there's, 115. There is not 115 draggers out there. If there are 40 draggers, 50 draggers persecuting squid during that small period of time, April 23rd to June 10th, that by the time they get to that small time where they might be inshore on the south side, those are generally the bigger boats in the fleet. The smaller boats don't go there. You're talking about a handful of boats. Now, I'm not saying that in federal waters it's a different story, but we're not here to discuss federal waters issues. We're here for the state petition. We make, you know, I've heard from Peter and I've heard from Bobby that we're not out for the hurt the small boats. But what this petition does is keeps me with my 6.5-inch bag fishing off the North Coast. That is the primary, that is who you are going to affect. And as Steve was saying, I too have put my time in the fishery management. I am the president of the Massachusetts Fishermen's Partnership. It's an umbrella organization of 21 fishing organizations in the state. I was the mobile gear representative for the Stillwagon Bank National Marine Sanctuary for 9 years. David can attest to the amount of time I put in at the New England Fishery Management Council. This problem, this petition is not going to solve any of your problems. None. Zero. So you've heard what the Division of Marine Fisheries staff has come up with. For analysis, you're hearing it from me, anecdotally, as they like to say, but I'm telling you, this predation, habitat degradation, it's happening everywhere. And it's not the reason why the stripers aren't within 3 miles. Now, I do realize the stripers are within 7 miles. I do know that if you go up off of Nauset, that's where all the stripers are. The stripers, the commercial striped bass fishery is about a quarter mile spot off of Nauset these days. There are stripers, they're just not here. And they're not here because I've come and fished off the Quahog grounds. So that's what I'd like to tell him. Thank you.
Thanks, Ed. Pete Kaiser.
Thank you again for showing up at this meeting. Appreciate it. I believe we're all a little bit on the same wavelength. We're not, you know, again, we've read your papers from way back when, and it's been brought up, a bunch of the small boat guys are saying, look, and we realize that the small boats don't have as much detrimental effect on the habitat. So, you know, we've requested from David and the crew to possibly come up with some exemptions because we realize the fact that small boats have been in the sound. So we are, you know, we've added that to the picture. We're not saying get rid of everybody. But the guys that have got history, small boats, we're willing to work and make that happen. Because, you know, hey, we've all been friends for a long time in the past. Now, this has got a lot to do with the boats on the outside, the increased pressure from the outside, which are mostly boats larger than 43 feet. You know, they're 50, they're 60, they're 70. Some of them were 75 feet that were cut down to 72 feet to be able to fish in state waters. And as we've seen on the west side of Matticat, that's where the increased pressure over the last 5 years has happened. Every year is more and more. It's at a point right now that the squid fishery, the industry itself, federally, is trying to set up some control dates because they realize there's so much more pressure coming into this fishery now that they're trying to say, look, as of a certain date, if the guys haven't been here, they're not going to allow the latent permits to become active. So there's definitely an increase of voting pressure, and everybody is aware of the fact that it can't sustain that much pressure, especially, like I say, hats off. I mean, it's amazing that we can have a fishery that's never been stronger in one respect, according to landings, on the west side, 3 miles off. And yet, again, with electronics from side-scan sonars to the large boats, you know, there's some excess of 100 foot. But in state waters, again, they got to be less than 72. They fish there up until June 9th. And then again lies one of the problems is that they're still spawning. They're still in full spawn. And the people here are saying, look, we'd appreciate if you did not extend that season past June 9th. Because, again, a lot of those boats with the coastal access permits, especially the Roll Island sector, are beating it up. The shallower they get, the better the gear fishes, and the less weather they have to worry about. All right, I just wanted to make that part of it straight. Again, we are proactive commercial fishing as long as it can be done respectably and it doesn't have the negative impact on the habitat. And one thing that we haven't mentioned too much about are the squid eggs, the squid mops. And when we were down in Rhode Island, everybody was sort of blindsided by the statement from the squid scientists for the Mid-Atlantic that stated that when these squid aggregate, they spawn, they're easier to catch, so everybody targets them. That's one thing. But when she said that the squid mops that are formed underneath these aggregations are attached to the bottom, that they need to be attached for 17 to 30 days in order to successfully hatch. Now, everybody was surprised by that statement because everybody, we didn't think anything of it. All the guys at Drag say we've been throwing it back forever. But she reinstated that they have to be attached. Since then, we've offered up some scientific data to Dr. Pierce and everybody that a lot of the scientists say, look, if you do detach those from the bottom, they bring them up on board, shovel them back over as fast as you can, still, their statements are that it's pretty much 100% mortality rate. And since we're fishing, you know, dealing with a very important forage food that only lives to be a year or less, that it's important to protect that. Now, that's just an element that we have to deal with. I've taken up a lot of time already. I'm just gonna give this as public comment. Let some other people speak. But I just want to say that we are not negative as far as commercial fishing. We've done it. I've done it up and down the coast for 30 years. Better. The small boats, we're trying to get an exemption for them. Take into that consideration, like he says. You've been fishing inside, and he doesn't even fish outside the harbor. But the big boats that are fishing on the outside definitely have a negative impact on what's going on here. All right, I'm going to cut it short and let some other people speak.
Okay, gentleman in the green sweatshirt.
Hi, Denny Dias, local fisherman. Those of you that don't know me, I'm a pretty hardcore beach guy, and just wanted to share an observation. I fish every spring hard all the beaches, and the eggs, or the squid mops, as you say, there is thousands all over the shores of Nantucket every spring, which touched on what Pete was just saying, and thank you.
To Tobias Glidden.
Great. Thank you for coming over today. Thank you, fishermen that have come, and thank you for everyone that showed up today. My name's Tobias Glidden. I'm myself and my family owns Glidden's Island Seafoods, a small family-run fish market on Nantucket, providing fish for the island since 1898. I also surf, cast, and jig from my small boat around the island for various fish that we can still catch. Having a family fish market for five generations teaches you a few things about economics and ecology of the island. First off, the market has gone from selling 100% locally caught seafood to roughly 80% imports, both domestic and foreign. This trend is one of the great losses to our community and economy. Simply, we are not sharing as many dollars. This story is not unique. Towns across New England have seen a steady decline in fish stocks, just as we have, and in so, a decline in our island. Tourists come from far and wide to enjoy the island's beauty, its cool waters, sandy beaches, an island of preservation, both in building and natural resources. All these features are great and treasures to protect. But what I wish to protect the most is my culture. My father always said, tourists and residents come to Nantucket for the people first and foremost. I quote, I wish to preserve my culture. Though I am only 28 and cannot tell you of the good old days when men rowed from shores of this island out to catch halibut, cod, just a few miles offshore, and ride the surf with great burgeoning boats filled with fish, the old days of herring and menhaden teeming in our harbors. I do not know the sweet joy of riding a wave into the shore, my boat filled with fish. I know none of this. I know when I was around 12, my father taking me down to the island's only creek out in Matticat. There I would hold a net and catch a half dozen herring. Now this, too, is gone for me. My father, my future son, will not share the memory. Perhaps he will not know how to fish. The link between catching tens of millions of pounds of forage fish, to me, is clear. I ask the Department of Marine Fisheries to please stop the excessive bycatch that takes place within 3 miles of Nantucket and put in place a mobile gear restriction to prevent further destruction of squid mops by the nets of bottom trawlers. Preserve the millions of pounds of forage and the whole bottom of the ocean food pyramid. Fishing is not the problem. Nets are. And especially small nets, small mesh. With the hope that Glidden's Island Seafood will continue to be able to sell locally caught fish into the future with great abundance, I please ask you to consider our ecology, economy, and most of all, our culture. And furthermore, I'd like to add that there are communities across the world, Washington, Oregon, California, the Mediterranean, Indonesia, Hawaii, that have in place small mesh bans. They seem to have a significant benefit in my mind in the sense that they are able to help balance the ecology without human input. When we have an intensive input and we're trying to manage all these factors across fisheries, I think it becomes difficult, and your presentation earlier alluded to that. We know historically we used to have huge levels of seals on the island, and we used to have huge fish stocks. Now we see more seals, and we're trying to manage all those pieces. I think if we step a little bit away and take a less intensive approach to managing our fisheries and let the fisheries balance themselves, I think that'll have a benefit. And lastly, I just urge you, this is a question of our culture and not just a question of economics. Thank you.
Well, who else would like to speak? Gentlemen, yeah, I'm blanking out. The impressive mustache. Sorry about that. John.
Thank you, Dr. Pierce. My name is John Herron, and I'm a selectman in the town of Dartmouth, and I'm also a sector manager. But as a selectman, I have heard from our sport fishermen and charter fishermen in Payneerham, Westport, Cuttyhunk, New Bedford. Their experience is the same problem you are here, but we unfortunately know the answer, seals. Today, speaking as a sector manager, I've heard the word overfished. My fishermen, since I'm a sector manager, do not overfish. We avoid fish. We fish avoidance. It's the worst thing you could ever think of, but it's a government-mandated program. You talk about cod. The cod have disappeared. Well, the cod have come back. We do not have enough quota to go catch cod such that every member in my two sectors, Sector 10, Sector 13, fish to avoid cod. I sent a boat up to the Gulf of Maine a couple of weeks ago. He went up there with all the quota we had for the Gulf of Maine, and I said, please use it, which he was going to. He came home because there was so much cod there. He went up there to target haddock and flounders. He came home because there was just so much cod there, and he refused to kill good cod just to harvest the intended flounders and haddock. Going back to the issue of discards, as a sector manager and National Marine Fisheries can back me up on this issue. On the ground fish side of things, we do discard, but when you look at it for the whole year, our discard rate is 3% to a maximum of 6%, and that has been going on since 2002 as a record. They keep track of it. Then when you talk about our fishermen, commercial fishermen, as to how much of their quota they harvest in the course of a year, we only harvest about 33%. We just, due to choke species and the diminished amount of effort there now is in the commercial fishing industry, they no longer can harvest their fishing. This is a vital area to a lot of boats in my sector because they've been forced out of the ground fishing industry by their own government. And so now they have to go to other fisheries to survive. And one of those fisheries is the squid industry. Now, when you talk about extra effort that may be here because of latent permits, yes, there may be some, but basically what I've monitored since 2010 till today is basically the same amount of boats in my sector fishing for squid. We have not had any increase, even though some boats in my sector do have those latent permits. There is some question of latent permits from New Jersey, New York, but they're on very small boats, and we don't think they're ever going to be active, but I can't guarantee that. But once again, we do not overfish, and it is a sustainable fishery. Every year, the squid population keeps growing, and I keep hearing we're putting extra pressure on it. But yet, every year, it's more and more abundant. The only sad part to say about that, and I hate to say it just in case it does come true in someday, everything is cyclical. And unfortunately, squid has a history of being cyclical. It has its ups and its downs. Thank you.
Thanks, John. Cormac Collins.
Hi, how are you? Cormac Collier. I'm the executive director of the Nantucket Land Council. We're an environmental organization on the island with a mission to protect the natural resources of Nantucket and its surrounding waters. Thank you very much for coming over today and allowing us to speak. Thank you also everyone else for showing up and for also to those that are coming to the island today as well. I wanted to just be on record for fully supporting the town's request as it's written in its October letter to DMF. And also its follow-up letter from just recent, the March 16th letter, to extend the buffer zone. I'm also in support. I know we're also sort of running up to quarter of one, so I'm not going to necessarily say everything that everybody's already said, but from what Bobby said today, thank you very much, and we're in full support of him and also our representative and our state senator. If I could just take a couple of minutes just to talk quickly in particular on the squid bumps and the bycatch. As Pete did explain, there is some opinions by some scientists out there in terms of the trawling's impacts on the squid bumps and its mortality. I did notice in your response letter of December to the selectmen, and then actually it was represented in your slides as well, where you stated the relationship between squid bumps reproductive success and stock status for this very short-lived species is unknown. And then in your very next slide, you came to a conclusion, it was written as a conclusion, that the squid mops did not need any protection. That to me seemed like there was a conclusion based upon absolutely no information. So if there's a belief that all this these relationships are unknown, and then you go further to make conclusions, I would hope that maybe in the future we could look at those impacts a little bit further. As Jeff Carlson stated, I want to reiterate the Nantucket Land Council's support to DMF for being partners, for providing funding, for looking at more efforts to garner additional information and additional science. We are there for you if you need that support. Further, in terms of the bycatch, as Mr. DaCosta stated, we also think those bycatch numbers are extreme and absolutely inappropriate. I again, in your response letter, was a little taken aback when you did state that There's no rigorous statistical test performed on the data or any pre-established standards for thresholds as to what is acceptable or not as it relates to the bycatch. Clearly, the amount of bycatch and the particular species that are involved, some of them, it is unacceptable. It's unacceptable from an ecological standard standpoint and from a habitat standpoint. Finally, I'd like to just reiterate concerns as it relates. It seems like we might do this all over again come June, although it's not necessarily going to be in a public hearing. It's going to be up to your discretion to issue letters of authorization to extend the season. And I guess you did present some information on your June in the June trawls that were based upon 24 trawls in terms of bycatch. In terms of that being any sort of statistical significance with as many trawls that are going on out there, totally understanding your limitations. So I do understand your limitations in terms of having observers out there, but that to me is not any does not have any statistical significance in terms of determining what the bycatch is in June and giving you then the confidence to extend the season, at least for the bycatch issue. Again, reiterate in terms of how we would like to work with DMF in the future, participate in future studies. Would like to finalize though by saying if all this information is unknown from the DMF, it seems that it's the most logical route to take is to apply a precautionary principle and hold back on some of these impacts before you actually get more information. Thank you.
Yeah, Tim Barrett.
Hello, everyone. My name's Tim Barrett. I'm a commercial fisherman. I own the fishing vessel Odessa, a vessel that many of you have seen here and seen here in the harbor. I have 35 years in the fishing industry. I have 25 years as a fishing boat captain. I have 20 years of fishing out in Nantucket here. And I'd like to speak as well for Sector 10. I'm the president of our fishing Sector 10. We have, I'd say, 15 different guys that fish in the sector. We have at least 10 or 12 of them that fish down here in the Sound. And we have 7 to 10 of them that fish right here in Nantucket for fluke. And we have another half a dozen of those same boats that fish for squid. Things have gotten very bad for us in the ground fishery, as our sector manager has stated. It's become an industry where it's very hard to make a living just because of the regulations that are there. In my 35 years of fishing, I have never seen a healthier ecosystem, either here in the Sound or on Stellwagen Bank or on George's Bank. I also have made frequent trips with UMass Dartmouth's Science, Marine, and Technology Group, which is has done science that helps with stock assessments throughout New England and the East Coast. I'd like to thank Dr. Pierce on his presentation. I think that they've gone through a lot of work to support what they have said, and Dr. Pierce doesn't support this petition. As a spokesman for Sector 10, I'd like to say that we do not support this petition either. I know a lot of you know me, and you see me around town quite a bit. But there are a lot of things that are being said here that are not correct. There's a lot of things about bycatch. If we were catching 50 pounds of bycatch for every 100 pounds we catch, we'd be exhausted by the end of the day. We don't fish that way. We are not demons. We are not trying to kill every last fish. We are not trying to put the recreational and the charter industry out. The things that have been said and some of the comments that have been run in the newspaper and run on the internet vilifies those of us that are hardworking individuals of a small-scale local community. I have a house. I have a daughter. She's going to college. I don't have any money. I need this fishery. Our sector needs this fishery. If there's regulations that are put in place, and I would request that Division of Marine Fisheries delay any further regulations for this year, because once those regulations are in place, they're nearly impossible to take away. And then the onus becomes on the Division of Marine Fisheries to start sorting out who gets letter of authorizations and doing more paperwork. They're very active in their support of the fisheries. They're very active in their management of the fisheries. And quite frankly, there's a lot of work that already gets done by the state. And I'd just like to say, you know, as president of Sector 10, we do not support any further action or this petition by the town of Nantucket. Thank you.
Thank you. To be respectful of the fact that those who came over from the Cape from Hyannis are going to likely have to get the ferry back. I mean, we're here for the duration. Who came over on the ferry and would like to speak? Yes, sir. Yeah.
Hello, my name is Mark Krzyzewski. I've been fishing the Sound for a very long time. That's all I do is fish. I don't have no degrees in anything. I dropped out of high school and I fished. That's all I do. But one thing I do is I notice a lot of things that a lot of people don't. And I know the squid fishery, everyone's saying, oh, the squid next year. There might not be a single squid show up next year. You never know. It just, that's the way the things go. So I know last year when Dan, they wanted to keep the fisheries open, couple extra days there, 5 or 6 days. I call him on the phone. Are you going to open it? The first thing he said, what's the bycatch like? And I said, there's no bycatch. It's perfectly clean. I sent the pictures. He said, okay. They used that to judge. If there was bycatch, they wouldn't have opened it. That's the way it was. Then we fished in the federal season over there. The squid, I picked every single one up with my hands, thousands of pounds of them. There was nothing. Clean squid. I mean, just shovel them into a box. No squid eggs, no squid mops. Later on, probably at the end of federal season, we started seeing some squid mops around. But the squid mops, these things are floating around. I see squid mops floating with little eyes in them that are almost developed squid. And I know this 57% bycatch. My crew would jump over the side if there's no way. They couldn't deal with 57% bycatch. If I see any kind of fish, I'm out of there. You know, you set your nets, you know, you put enough floats on them to keep them off the bottom. I mean, there's a lot of things. And, you know, these young fellows from Senator Sears, they're talking about, you know, a depletion of squid. Now, there's no depletion of squid. There's more squid than ever. I mean, and if you just don't understand about fishing. There's people trying to make decisions for the fishermen that don't know anything about fishing, and they hear all this hogwash that everyone's throwing around, bycatch and this, and everyone's gullible and they believe it. It's just like watching the news. I quit watching TV 3 years ago because of this. And this is what your people are listening to. And you have no idea. You know, everyone hears it. They're good people. They want to do something that's good. But in doing that, they're making some of the wrong decisions because, you just can't save everything with bad information. You need to have the right information to save something. And that's basically all I have to say. I mean, I don't support this closure, but I understand everyone's concerns. Everyone's all up in arms about it. But, you know, it's not there. I mean, the damage is not being done. And I wouldn't have anything to do with it if there was. I'd be gone. I couldn't deal with that. I just couldn't deal with it. And a lot of other people couldn't. Small boat fishermen, you just want to pull up a nice clean squid, shovel them into a box, and be gone, and that's the end of it. All right, everyone, God bless.
Okay, thank you, Mark. Because a number of people have commented about the bycatch, and of course I provided slides of some observer information that the Mid-Atlantic Council has provided in tabular form. Dan really takes the lead on gathering information regarding bycatch and the fisheries in our state waters, notably squid. So I'm going to turn to him and ask him to provide some explanation as to how we acquire that information.
Yeah, thanks, David. We did get the call, and that was my first question. And so with that in mind, what we did is we called the National Marine Fisheries Service for their squid or their sea sampling data, and they instantly provided us the data that they had even before it had been key punched. And so they faxed over the information in the previous week from the day I called. I said, okay, what do you have for sea sampling data? Can you send it to me? And they did send it to us. And so that's the summary of what David provided was data that we got cooperatively from the federal government. And really, that's the best we can do. I mean, as a state agency, we don't have a roving team of observers. Besides, the federal government is spending a lot of their resources on collecting this observer data. And so we were confident that the run of squid was still, A, really strong in terms of the abundance of the weight and then the average size, because it's our experience over the years that we've dealt with this fishery is squid show up when temperature hits 50 degree Fahrenheit. Some years that squid run is delayed if we have a cold spring. This particular year of 2016, it was a little bit delayed. It got really strong in the middle of May, and so we were confident that this was sort of a late run. Our regulations as drafted really were based on our historical experience with the run of squid, especially in Nantucket Sound proper, becoming mixed with a lot of small, mostly unmarketable squid, and the discard of undersized scup going up. So the fishery has those features. The middle of the run, when the fishing is strong, you tend to catch large squid and you tend to catch large fish. And as it peters out in Nantucket Sound, just the opposite happens. So that's how we made our decision. We got as much sea sampling data opportunistically as we could from the federal government. But you're right. My first question was, what's the bycatch look like? But the answer that we got was really from sea sampling data, not just from fishermen's reports. But I appreciate that.
Yes, the young lady there in the middle.
My name is Katie, and I'm coming over from Point Judith today. I just wanted to touch a bit on what the gentleman before me had said about having the right facts and having correct scientific studies on this, because coming from Point Judith, I'm sure a lot of you guys know, it's essentially the squid capital of the East Coast United States. We depend on squid, especially the summer run. We depend on these areas south of the island and in Nantucket Sound. A couple of our vessels do have that permit. Squid makes the port of Point Judith, and squid could potentially break the port of Point Judith if we lose access to the squid. There are many, as you guys have economic impacts from the ocean as well, as do we. There are people whose livelihoods and jobs depend on the run of this this squid in the summer and access to these grounds. We've been fishing these grounds, well, not me, but the fishermen for decades, and the squid showed up every year. So again, having the right information, scientific, is just extremely important, because these decisions have incredible impacts on not only your port, but our port too.
Okay, thank you. Before I go back to the Nantucket residents, anyone else who came over on the ferry, do you care to speak? Okay, Jason Letko?
Jason's not here.
Okay, how about Janet Schulte?
Thank you for coming and rescheduling this hearing. My name is Janet Schulte. I'm the Executive Director of the Nantucket Island Chamber of Commerce and Head of the Regional Tourism Council for this district. I'm here to talk with you about the broader impact that sports fishing and charter fishing has for the Nantucket economy and community beyond the direct fishing economy of charter boats, tackle shops, and fish markets. I'm talking about the local economy, state and local taxes, our culture, and the length of our visitor season. First, people who come to Nantucket to fish need a place to sleep, places to eat, places to shop, and in bad weather, places to play. It doesn't matter how they fish, by charter boat or sport fishing. The visitor who fish rents cottages or homes or a room at one of our lodging establishments. They frequent our restaurants and bars. They buy a cup of coffee at one of our charming coffee shops or markets. They rent a car or a bike or take the bus. They hit one of our ice cream shops for a cone. visit the museums and historic sites, maybe attend church and leave an offering, and shop for equipment and for souvenirs and mementos. These shops, eateries, lodging places, and activities all have employees who also add to the local economy when they pay their rent, eat out, buy groceries, shop, and play. And there are the taxes, sales, lodging, and meals taxes that are generated for the state and municipal coffers. Those taxes fund the programs we depend on as a society: government offices, public schools, police and fire, highways, public works, and social service programs. When those visitors come from other states to Nantucket, the money they spend here are paying Massachusetts taxes to add to our coffers. In the tourism world, we call that OPM, other people's money, and we say thank you very much for visiting. Fish are part of Nantucket's culture. When you walk through the retail shops downtown, you see t-shirts with bluefish or striped bass emblazoned on them. The haberdasheries sell belts with bluefish on them that recognizes the Nantucket bluefish belt all around the world. We have fish printed on baseball caps, and on one establishment here, it will take your catch and make a print of it for you. Artists paint, carve, and sculpt images of fish that are sold in galleries and trunk shows all over the island and at our local Artist Association Gallery, as well as our weekly farmers market. Many of our shops and restaurants, besides the fish markets, use an image of fish on their signs and logos. And fishing extends our visitor season, and that extends our economy. When visitors come in May and June, and September and October to fish our waters, those visitors are increasing the population we see in the shoulder season. We're packed in July and August, but every shop owner, restaurateur, hotelier, and service provider is delighted to have more visitors in those shoulder months. Please support the seasonal closure for Nantucket. Those fish are an essential link in the food chain of Nantucket's cultural life and our tourist economy. Thank you.
Which one? Yes, yes, sir, in the plaid shirt. Down the front. Which one? You, yeah. You're next.
Hi, I'm Captain Doug Smith. Been a commercial fisherman all my life, working on the island here. 12 years on Peter's deck. Worked with Bobby DaCosta 6 years, running his boat. I'm now a master captain running a charter boat. We've heard about the keyhole issue of all of us and the difficulty in the fisheries. I am here to support the small boat fisheries in the Sound. I've worked, for the past 4 years, I've worked out of Matticat, and I take my charter boat around the backside of the island. I haven't heard a large boat fisherman here yet today. When I go to work every day and see 20 boats lined up on that same tow that you showed on your chart, I have to worry about the effort that's being spent in that area. We always need to be flexible in our decisions made in this industry, and the fishing effort in the Sound has gone down, whereas the fishing effort on the backside has increased, at least from my visual standpoint and the fact that I'm there every day. If for some reason we could leave the Sound open for the small boat guys that aren't on the south side, it is the south side where I see this effort. Also, that area, as well as being a spawning area and a migration route for the squid, it's also a migration route for our game species, our bluefish and our striped bass. And I could talk about butterfish, fluke, alewife, scup, black sea bass, and the pelagics. You know, our tuna fish are moving further offshore every year. We went 50 miles this year to catch juvenile bluefin tuna in the charter industry. I have to ally with the small boat fishermen and the fisheries in the Sound. What I'm worried about is that one tow that you showed us on the south side of the island in between the sector inshore and the sector offshore. Again, as I am now a charter boat captain, I'm ripping striped bass and I'm cleaning bluefish, whereas a lot of times I didn't see what was in the stomachs of these fish. But I consistently see bluefish full of squid. And we also have a great run of forage, of our target species, the bluefish and the striped bass inshore, with the already hatched young squid. They'll come through around the beginning of August, again, with water temperatures and the migration and the amount of fish that come in any given year, you know, the cyclical matter to that. I want to thank you guys for coming here and giving us the opportunity to speak. And, again, I'm allied with the guys in the Sound, but what scares me is those big boats on the south side. And I can go out any given day during the squid season and count anywhere from 20 to 30 draggers on that same tow that you showed me. And I won't get into bycatch and I won't get into everything, but thank you for the opportunity.
Just a quick question. Yeah. Would you, with that said, would you favor a continuation of large mesh fishing on the southern side of Nantucket?
Sure.
For large mesh fishing, you would favor not a complete ban.
Well, again, you know, you're getting your data from the government, and I'm not a draggerman. I've been a rod and reel fisherman all my life, and I worked out of ports between Montauk and Kennebunkport, chasing whatever we could make a buck at. And as long as the science provides that some of our bait species are getting through, again, the alarm in the alewives bycatch, herring, you know, we've seen pelagics migrations move due to the overfishing. I fished out of Kennebunkport for 16 years. We watched the pelagics move out of the Gulf of Maine because of the herring fishery there. And then the herring fishery came down south and is now working out of east of the Cape and Island here. We've watched pelagics be affected by the bait fish scenario. And I think a lot of this is fueled by the bait fish scenario and also the squid, you know, the small squid bycatch. These are the targets that are migratory, what I'll call target fish, rely on and need. I fished off the beach at Tuckernuck and on the south shore of the island when I started fishing here in the early 70s. And we could catch between 200 and 300 pounds every night of striped bass. And I understand the problem with recruitment in the Chesapeake and in the Hudson River. But we've watched. If I were to go take you fishing this summer at the height of the bass season, I'd be real happy if we caught our limit of keepers. And again, we've got this 1 year class now that, you know, that were too small to keep last year. And I've been involved in management and I know how hard your job is. And I just want to thank you for coming. And any more questions? Thank you, Doctor. Thank you.
About Larry Cronin.
Thank you for coming down. Thankful for the people showing up. I've been fishing out of Nantucket for 43 years. Prior to that, I fished all the way from the north coast of Newfoundland to Rhode Island, commercially sometimes and recreational. I think today's meeting has really been an eye-opener, and I thank everybody for showing up, people coming from off-island, and giving us an idea of how their fishery is going. I have watched the fishery over a span of time, probably 50-something years or more, and I've seen the heyday of the Boston T-War fishery at its probably coming to its end when 150,000 pounds of fish were coming in every day. I've seen the fishery collapse and regain. I think there's got to be a solution. Nantucket is unique. It has an upwelling system that works amazingly well. This upwelling system comes through Vineyard Sound, Nantucket Sound, and Nantucket Shoals. This is a cold water, warm water system. It's very unique in Nantucket Sound because of the shallow water. It reaches, it gets very warm. Cold water coming down outside of the eastern, and the tide changes create a multitude of feed that feeds the whole bottom of the lower fish chains. And this particular movement of feed going out of the area between Great Point and Monomoy and the area between Cuttyhunk and Nomans feeds a vast area both north and south, protecting our inshore fisheries is a way that we can bring back the fisheries in different areas and create a commercial and a recreational comeback to the fisheries. Thank you.
Yeah, you, gentlemen. Yes, you. Yeah. Yes.
Good afternoon, Director Pearson, members of your staff. Thank you for coming down to the island today and braving a high wind advisory and rescheduling this hearing. And my name is Carl K. Borchert. I'm a local resident. And I appreciate your presentation, Dr. Pierce. It was very informative, and I learned a lot. Thank you for that. And thank you, sir, for all your work as a deputy and everybody on your team. I really appreciate it. I began a lifelong interest in offshore wind power in 2001. I'm an offshore wind advocate by hobby. I studied monopole foundations and scouring material as far as benthic life and stimulating fishing in Nantucket Sound on Horseshoe Shoal through the Cape Wind Project. I still am an offshore wind energy advocate. I served on the Energy Study Committee on the town from 2007 to 2011. I served on the Coastal Management Plan Work Group in 2012 with Mr. DaCosta and others, and Mr. Carlson. Learned a lot about the 3 mile zones, the high tide mark, energy in the ocean, erosion control issues. We produced a coastal management plan for the town. Currently, I serve on the planning board here as an alternate. I've served for 3.5 years. And I'm quite interested in local affairs. I support a ban on mobile gear fishing between May 1 and October 31st each year in our state waters. I'm asking that our county be included with the other 90% of coastal towns in the state who already have this ban in place. I am not a fisherman, but I understand that trawling and dragging on the ocean floor during squid spawning season destroys squid egg mops. It is estimated that 19 million pounds of squid were taken last year as well. I believe that these two factors have a direct negative impact on predator fish such as striped bass, bluefish, and others, which make up our recreational industry here. This industry is a significant part of our local economy. I support implementing this ban immediately and studying this issue further. I'd also like to add, which is not written by me, but I thought about it for the last couple of hours, I fully support Mr. Kaiser, Mr. DaCosta, Mr. Blount, and I'm sorry, I can't recall your name, sir. Tom?
No, I'm Fred.
Fred. Well, not even close. But anyway, I fully support these local fishermen who are speaking very passionately. And the reason why, the primary reason why I support them is because these gentlemen and they have spent their entire lives practically in local waters. And I understand that you and your team have spent your entire careers in local waters. But these gentlemen have been out there on the water. I'm not a fisherman, as I have said. But these particular gentlemen, Mr. DaCosta, Mr. Kaiser, and everybody else here, have submitted this petition for a reason. All we're basically asking is to be included along with 90% of the other communities in the state from May 1st to October 31st. It's a simple petition, okay? So that's all we're asking. And these people really are knowledgeable and they really care about Nantucket, and I care about Nantucket because I grew up here and live here. All we're asking is for this petition to be considered very seriously and to be taken that way. Thank you.
My name's Bill Blount. I own the fishing vessel Ruthie B. It's the last large offshore dragger out of Nantucket. And this law will not affect me because I'm too big to fish in state waters. But I'd like to give my two cents on this, if I can. And first of all, as far as the disappearance of the striped bass and the bluefish around the island and maybe the forage fish as well, I think the problem is the seals. They not only, I think, eat the striped bass and the bluefish, I'm very confident they also eat the squid. They've effectively driven the codfish out to about the 60 or 70 fathom line off the Cape, and if they can do that, I can guarantee you they're gonna clean up everything around this island. The other thing is that I fished out in Nantucket since, 75, so I said 40 years, and my experience is that, you know, the island has made a lot of mistakes as far as commercial fishing. Right now there's only three guys left doing it, and I think if you put this ban through as it is there and a blanket closure around the whole 3 miles, I think that's wrong. I think it's going to hurt the fishery and commercial fishermen in on this island and for the long term for several reasons. One is that the potential for young guys to come along, most likely they would go into a small boat fishery or start with a small boat. And that's where, as you've seen, a number of the guys that came over from the Cape, this would be the fishery they would go into. So as far as I'm 71, 72, I'm kind of old to do what I'm doing. I haven't got many years left, if any. So, but as far as young men coming into this, into commercial fishing, and we're an island, we need to, I think, leave that open because that's the fishery most likely they would go into. I think as I see the taking place, I see sea scalloping going down. Lobstering, I'm not sure what's happening with that, but ground fishing is definitely coming back. I've been in this since the early 50s, sword fishing primarily, but then as soon as I got into high school, I got into ground fishing. My experience is that we're kind of between the southern fish, the fluke, scups, sea bass, and squid, and to the northern fish, the cod, haddock, flounders, halibut, whatever. And we go in cycles. And so we have a warming trend and the fluke show up, and we go on a cooling trend and the codfish come. And I think we're going out of a 30-year warming trend, and we're going into a cooling trend. And what I can see, it looks like we have is, as far as groundfish goes, I would think it's like 100 to 130-year cycle, with 30 bad years and 70 to 100 good years. And with peaks and drops in between. So I think as far as dragging goes, dragging has been very seriously oppressed because most of it's been ground fishing, and we've really struggled. I'm with the observer having to pay for observers and for everything else. I'm in Sector 7, and it's really difficult to make any ends meet. But the groundfish had come back. For the last 4 years, codfish have increased. All groundfish has increased dramatically, as you know, sir, I'm pretty sure well, and I know you're doing studies to prove to National Marine Fisheries Service that this is taking place, and as well as the sector manager from 10 and 13 said, you know, he gave testimony that was true as well. And so I think groundfishing is going to make a tremendous comeback, and it's very important to the state because I think fishing and fishing-related stuff, I think, is the number three employer in the state. So we're very important, even though there's just a handful of guys that are providing the fish for the majority of the employment. And so right now, there's nobody left in ground fishing. There's, 35, 40 boats actually actively doing it out of, 600 permits? That's probably the whole coast. But I see it, once they open up codfish, it's going to take off, and it's going to be the thing for the state to do. It's going to replace sea scalloping, that's what I believe. And you're going to see sea scalloping going down, as in the 80s, the guys couldn't even pay for the fuel. And now they've had tremendous, trips and stuff. But everything cycles, and so I think the state has to consider that. So one thing I think is that young men that may want to go into it, especially here we're an island, would may want to go into that. The other thing is that the state's going to need the ground fleet back, and how are you going to do that? I hope you don't give all the scallopers groundfish permits. I hope you would rather bring up young people another whole fishery as well. And I think that the scallopers are too big and could do too much damage to it. It'd be hard to control. But again, I think the state's got to consider that. And I think that in your decision to not view this, I expect that some consideration is that. And it's that the guys that were here from Scituate and whatever, and the smaller boats anyway that are fishing in the state waters originally were groundfish boats, and they're squidding and they're fluking because that's the only way they can make it. But someday if ground fishing comes back, you're going to need those guys to go ground fishing, and their experience. And so I think maybe something needs to be done and be fine-tuned on this, that where we can, if you want to protect the fish to the south, whatever. But as far as a general blanket closure, I don't think it's smart. And I think it's harmful. Nantucket has had a habit of making bad decisions as far as commercial fishing goes. And I think this, if a whole blanket one is another bad decision for the island, frankly. And I think it's not smart. So, whatever.
Thank you. The last one on this formal list is Brian Borgeson.
He's not here.
Okay. Anyone else care to speak? Yes, sir.
Hi, my name's Matt Rainamo. I'm a Nantucket native and have been a charter captain now for 20 years, which is hard to believe. I don't feel that old, but... I guess I'm getting there. I also I own the other tackle store on Nantucket, so I've got a lot of stuff riding on this. And first, I just want to point out that a lot of the guys that were here, the off island guys, and everybody that was pro, they supported your decision, our tentative decision. And they'd like to see continued dragging. What they relied upon, it seemed a lot, was this anecdotal evidence. Oh, what I'm seeing is this, what I'm seeing is that. So I think it's important to take a look at this room, and who is packed with local fishermen, and all of whom, I don't want to speak for them, but everybody who stood up here is in favor of this ban. And perhaps more importantly, Bobby DaCosta and Pete Kayser, who there's not two other guys that have spent more time on the water on this island and know more about the fishery and have seen more about it. So the fact that these are the two guys who are spearheading this should weigh pretty heavily on your decision, I think, because their expertise in these waters, if you're going to listen to anybody anecdotally, they're the two guys you should be listening to. And I think it it goes even further to say that you know, these guys are not always pro-conservation, which I tend to be. We've kind of been on the opposite sides of something, but these guys are not, you know, they're happy to let guys make a living and kill fish and are sometimes pro-commercial, but, you know, this time they see a problem and they realize that this is necessary. This is a necessary thing. So I'd like to thank them, and certainly if you're listening to anecdotal evidence, that's the anecdotes you should be listening to. When you had those charts up before about the reported striped bass landings, I noticed in all of them that the other counties in Massachusetts have had a recent spike. You know, they've benefited somewhat from the 2011 year class that everybody's placing a lot of hope in. And I won't get into how I think, you know, it's dangerous that everybody here is placing a lot of hope in a single year. As far as this fishery getting better. But Nantucket and Dukes County didn't have that spike. We haven't enjoyed any of these 2011 numbers. If you read that John McMurray article, which I'm sure you have, it states in there very plainly, his fishing off New York is getting a little better. We all had to endure reports from Provincetown of great striped bass fishing this last spring, and we're still catching, you know, very, very low numbers, not what we're used to. So, however those net bans came into place, the 3 miles for the rest of the state, historically, I don't see that that matters much. What it means now is the places with those bans are enjoying great striped bass fishing. Sometimes we're starting to see a little bit of this 2011 year class, and Nantucket and Martha's Vineyard that don't enjoy that, our numbers are steadily declining. So whereas, you know, maybe there is some hope for 2011, that hope hasn't come to Nantucket yet. So we have to kind of figure out why that is. And in the face of what you say is imperfect science, and we don't have support for this, I just think it's irresponsible and irrational to say, let's keep doing what we're doing. Because you don't get a room that's this filled and this many people if what you're doing is working. It's not working. So it's time to put the brakes on, and ban the nets for the time being, until the science gets better, if that's what you're looking for. But we can't continue down this path. Now, another point that was brought up by, you know, several of the previous speakers was youth. And you know, you want to keep this open for the fishermen of the future. Well, again, I don't want to speak for anybody here, but I see a lot of people out here my age and younger, and to a person, I would say, no more nets. The people that are my age and younger are begging, pleading, stop killing the forage fish. Stop it. Just let nature be for a little while. You know, I know Pete's doing this for his son. You know, you see a lot of people out there. I have a son. I don't know if anybody here has as much economically to lose as me. Owning a tackle store, you know, having a charter business. But I don't care. You know, I don't care. Do the right thing. Do it so my son can fish if he wants to, can go out and know what it's like to grow up here and be able to go catch fish. This is the right thing to do. Get, you know, ban nets within 3 miles. Thanks.
Yeah, I got a second. Hold on a second. Yeah, you want a tackle shop. You a charter boat captain, so you obviously have your ear to the ground. Do you have any observations that you can share with us regarding water temperature? You know, any notable temperature changes on the backside of Nantucket or elsewhere that might have an impact on the distribution of some of these fish, like striped bass?
I don't think that, you know, there's obviously kind of a gradual warming, but we've had cold springs. We've had cold springs the last couple of years. And, you know, 10 years ago, the rips south of Nantucket, Old Man Shoal in June, I don't think the water temps were any cooler than we've enjoyed the last few springs. And it was alive with squid, alive with striped bass, alive with everything. And, you know, the last 3 years, that's been a far cry. I don't know that it's fishless, but if you go now and fish it 10 times over the spring and you get one or two decent days with a couple fish, that's good. That's all you can hope for. Whereas, you know, 5-10 years ago, if you got a lure near that rip in June, it didn't take long for a big striped bass to be attached to it. So, yeah, is fishing getting more difficult? Absolutely. Do I think that that this is the only problem? Absolutely not. You know, I think it's, you mentioned seals, you mentioned some other things that are potential problems, but I think that to kind of look at those and point those out is irresponsible, because what you're doing is saying, hey, it's not this, it's that, it's not this, it's that. And you're just, you know, it's a lot of red herrings, but eventually everything becomes a red herring. So, you know, people in my shoes and a lot of people here aren't saying, well, let's try to find the real problem. We're asking you to address every problem. This is definitely part of the problem. I don't know if it's all of the problem, but it's part of it, and it's the part you can do something about. So we're asking you to do something about the part that you can do something about. Same kind of logic applies to the federal side. Like, okay, maybe most of this is a federal problem, but not all of it's a federal problem. So just because you can't address the federal part of the problem doesn't mean you shouldn't address the state part that you can address. This is part of the, you know, you need to fight this, and we need to protect our ecosystem, protect our fisheries on all fronts, not just toss out other fronts as an excuse why we're not going to do what we can.
Thank you. Dr. Roger Hanlon said he'd make a short presentation if you
could see that. Well, let me ask you the question first. Who else would like to speak on this issue? Well, go ahead. If Roger's available, if he can give a short presentation regarding his research, then, I'm sorry. Yes, sir, go ahead.
I just like to represent the fishermen that go out maybe an hour after dinner just in hopes of catching a fish for a dinner type of situation. I've lived on the island for about 4 years. I've been coming to the island since my honeymoon in 75, built a house in 84. And so this is a great place to live. The issue that I'd like to just bring up is when you fish the South Shore, you look left and right and you see nobody anymore. You see nobody surf casting on the South Shore. And the reason is there's just no fish to catch, okay? Every once in a while, I can show you, I'm a chemical engineer and I write down a lot of things. For instance, it was 50 degrees in the second week in November, just to let you know how warm the water was then. But, you know, you go and there's no fish in sight. And so in your presentation, you gave data on striped bass that showed that there's been a decline. But how do you explain the fact that there are no bluefish to catch on the South Shore? What's happened to the bluefish? Where's your data? Do you have data that shows that there are less bluefish babies in 2004 and 2010? You know, there's a lot of science that still has to be gained, and there's a lot of anecdote discussions, but I can't catch a fish. I can't catch my dinner anymore when I go fishing on the South Shore. So something is wrong, and it could be a lot of factors, But maybe the best experiment, the best scientific experiment, I realize that it affects industries, is to shut it down and see what happens in 1, 2, 3 years and see if the fish come back. That would be a nice scientific experiment to run.
Yes, Dr. Pierce, thank you for coming and thank you for your staff coming. I also want to appreciate the fact that the environmental police are here as well. I know they don't work for you, but we're all in this together. So thank you for that and thank you for everyone showing up. My name is Tim Madden, and I just, I know we want to get to this slide here and I don't want to delay it much, but there's a couple of things that I'd like for you to think about as you proceed. You came out with your recommendations and they were preliminary and so forth, and I just want us to understand that they were preliminary. The whole idea of a public hearing is to get the public input and perhaps ascertain some additional information that you didn't have and perhaps put other perspectives on things that you had thought about that you might think of differently now. A couple of things really come to mind that have kind of surfaced here more today, that there seems to be some additional information regarding squid mops and so forth. And I think there needs to be a little bit additional information and education about that, some of which I believe we're going to hear about. I heard you say something which was, as though I tend to agree with Mr. Rynamo's comments on a lot of them, but you mentioned something about maybe larger mesh. I think that's something that's been discussed before as well. So the idea that you brought it up in one of your questionings back and forth showed a sign of encouragement that at least we can reach with perhaps a different outcome than your initial recommendation, and that we can come to some compromise and bear in mind that there might be some additional information from studies that need to become forward before anything is etched into granite. The other thing is I think it's, we can't lose fact that the 90% of the Commonwealth or whatever the actual number of counties and so forth that have a different set of rules is and it almost implied in your comments that it was political in nature back in the 1930s. Let's hope those days are somewhat behind us, that things are made strictly for political reasons. And for obvious reasons, I say that wholeheartedly. But with that being said, there isn't an inequity that people fail to understand. And I think that needs to be addressed more clearly as well. So with that, you know, one of the immediate things I think you're going to be in front of is obviously your decision coming up shortly, but also the LOAs. You know, that was very disheartening last year when additional ones were sent out. But you know, hopefully that's a small step in the right direction as we move forward. But most importantly, I just want to conclude by saying I have worked with you for a number of years and your agency, and I find that the fact that you've come here and you listened afforded two things. First of all, it showed that you were willing to come out and make these trips. Additionally, I think it has provided people of Nantucket to feel as if they have a voice. And additionally, probably more so today than in other hearings, it's allowed from Nantucketers to hear from people from off island that have a different perspective or a different experience that they've been able to share with us. And it's helped us understand some decisions you're making. So with that, I just want to thank all of you. I thank everyone who's contributed and appreciate you allowing me to speak. Thank you.
Thanks, Tim.
Yes, just take a second. Thanks for coming, Doctor. I know it's probably not easy to do since the people here are all in favor of extending the, trying to stop the draggers from doing all their damage. But I'd like to let the audience know that the Division of Marine Fisheries pays for and collects information on recreational fishers on Nantucket. I've been doing that for the past 3 years. So we don't have to rely on anecdotal evidence of people that happen to live here. There is science. There are hard numbers that show there's a dramatic decline in the number of fish caught around Nantucket shores. So I'm confused because I heard that you did not have the science to back up the fact, and you know it's available on NOAA's site. But later you had a graph showing that the increase in the number of stripers caught has gone up everywhere except Nantucket and Dukes County, which it seems to be obvious that if we can do anything that get those numbers back up, let's do that. And let's recognize the fact that where the numbers are increasing is where the 3-mile limit is extended. And where it's not is where it's not. So let's hear it for aesthetic.
Dr. Pierce, you've heard a lot of testimony today, and I was, again, I'd like to thank the offshore, the dragger guys that were here, but they've all left. They got the boat home, hopefully. Hopefully you will as well. But I wanted to give you a compromise. And this is one thing I learned 6 years of politics. It's all about compromise. And that would be that we, I believe all of us, feel the hurt for the small dragger guys, the Eddies and the Barretts, and we know those guys. We've known them forever. They, you know, like you said, they've been fishing here for 20 years. They tie up on our town pier when they had a byboat, and they're primarily, they squid early in the year, and they fluke the rest of the summer. So my compromise would be is that we would like to see a closure from May 1 to October 31st from Muskeget Channel, from Muskeget Channel buoy, the south side of Nantucket, the east side of Nantucket to Great Point. And it's no mystery here why we're asking for this. Those guys don't fish down that side of the island. The boats that do are not small boats. They're big boats. And it's you're well aware that the reason that this was even on Mid-Atlantic Council's table this spring was because of pressure from Pete and from the town of Nantucket. And that we really want to get a closure on the south side of the island. The fact that 19 million pounds of squid came out of one small area, roughly 6 by 12 miles, is just that spot can't take that kind of pressure. And for us, we feel it's imperative that we have a state closure so that we can go to the federal government and say, look, the state stepped up and did the right thing. Now we need you to do the right thing. We're not saying they can't catch these squid. And I know Point Judith is the squid capital of the world, but Point Judith has a lot of area to fish, and they don't need that little 6 by 12 miles. Those squid all aren't there for, they're there for one reason. They're there to spawn. And then they spread out. And our concern is that if they keep beating on this with the additional pressure, and I've been fishing south of the island since I was 9. So that's a lot more than 20 years. And I know how much dragger pressure has been down there, and I can tell you how much more there is in the last 7 to 10 years, since basically 2006, 2007. And I can also tell you that that's when we started to see the decline in not just bass. Let's talk a lot about stripers, but I was glad to hear that last speaker talk about bluefish, because our bluefish numbers are way down, and yet you say bluefish landings are up. So, you know, this was the bluefish capital of the world. You know, Nantucket Blues is world famous, not striped bass. And we don't have anywhere near the bluefish numbers. Freddie will attest. Freddie takes bluefish trips from the marina. That's all he does. He keeps track of every trip, how many fish he catches. And he will stand up and tell you that he used to catch 50 fish in a 2.5 hour trip. And now he's lucky if he gets one for every person on his boat. That's how down our bluefish numbers are. And it could, the bluefish at Great Point feed primarily on squid and sand eels in the summertime. And not all those squid come out of the sound. The majority of them come down the back side of the island and the east side of the island. So if you were to give us a closure from May 1 to October 31st on the south side of the island, you wouldn't affect the small boat guys in the sound. They could still fluke. They could still squid in the spring. But it would give us a start to try to get that backside fixed. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Okay, Bob, you can decide.
Yeah, I just want to bring up what Bobby said. For some reason, I keep logs. And I've been in this kind of business for over 50 years because I used to run headboats down in New York. And when I came to Nantucket, I did it part-time. And then I went into the boat basin in 86. And from 1986 up to now, I have accurate logs. They're probably well over 99% accurate, and I can guarantee you, I'll put my life on it. God is my witness. The numbers were up here, they're way down here now. And that's 32 years, and I always ask, even that, they always ask me, why doesn't the state or somebody come by and take this data from you? And I have this data, and there's thousands and thousands of trips in here. It ain't no a couple hundred, it's thousands of trips. But it's accurate, and the numbers are way down.
Well, Ralph? Ralph? Is it Ralph?
Freddie.
Freddie. Just go to show how good my memory is.
Freddie.
What's your last name?
Tonkin, T-O-N-K-I-N.
Okay. Well, thank you for that offer. I'm going to...
On a lot of the trips, thank God, the SCUP are around, and we have something to catch the people's stuff. Because I just... really, the bluefish numbers are way down.
Okay, well, we'll likely be in touch with you, okay?
Oh, thank you. It would take months probably to get these.
You can leave your contact information. There's a sign-up sheet in the back if you would just leave something for us to reference, okay? Ma'am, you raised your hand behind Freddie? No? Okay. Yes, sir.
My name is Mark Gentner, owner and operator of the Charboat Just Do It 2 since 1986, right next to Fred. Definitely see a decline in bluefish. We talk back and forth throughout the charter boats, and I fish the north side of Nantucket. Definitely a problem. I think it's lack of bait that makes, because I used to fish between Tuckanuck, coming out of there, fish the channel, stripers get my limits. Now, don't even go there. Stay in the harbor, fish the harbor, it's very slow for bass. We all race to Great Point. Freddie and I fish Great Point. So there is definitely a decline in the bluefish.
Question for you. I've heard from other recreational fishermen, charter boat captains in particular, especially on the Cape, that their trips, where they go, how successful they are, is now havoc because of the abundance of seals. In the Chattamary, for example. Now, you've got an unbelievable abundance of seals, Muskeget Island and elsewhere. The heads are popping up everywhere. Your experience as a charter boat captain, can you comment on the extent to which seals are interacting with you and impacting the quality of your trips?
We actually go out and around. We don't fish near the rip, near the point, because it's full of seals anyway. So we go out by around the rip, start fishing a little further out. Stay away from the seals as much as possible and fish through the drain holes at Great Point. Sometimes, even when I'm fishing on the bottom, off just outside the jetties, seals will come right up and we'll be bottom fishing for scup or whatever. Sometimes the seals are even issued right along the north shore, right in close to the beach. So definitely, when I worked on the Flicker in 1983, 84, 85, never saw a seal. It was a big deal to see a seal. Now they're everywhere. So in that amount of time from then, the seal population has just gone crazy.
Have you lost any important fishing grounds, the historical grounds where you've always had success? Because of seals.
Great Point.
Oh, yeah,
Great Point. All of us charter boat guys, Muskeget, Great Point, through the cut. I think the bass come through the channel there, and that all slowed down because they come right around, go through, and come into the harbor. And that's where I fish mainly, because my short 2.5-hour trips, I'll fish the harbor and the north shore and close. Jetty Rocks definitely slowed down because of lack of bait coming around through the cut. I think that's part of the issue. That's why I'm here today. I listened right to the very end before I had to say something about it, to hear a little different views. So I've been, like I say, doing it since I was a kid. Captain since '86.
Okay.
Right next to Fred.
Fred, you want to follow up?
I'm not like Bobby and Pete. I do 2.5-hour trips. Occasionally, I'll do one down the beach. But even at Great Point, because I usually, when the bassing was real good down there, like to the, off of a Poachick Rip or out by the, Fishing Rip or whatever, I'd always catch bass at the Great Point. Not in big numbers, but there was every day we'd get maybe a couple of trips some days. Now I'll go weeks on end in the summer and maybe catch one striper, because there's... And another thing that Bobby didn't mention, a lot of the stripers they catch, their stomachs are filled with crabs. They're not filled with squid. They're rock crabs.
Okay, anyone else? Yes, sir.
Andy Lowell, local, born and raised here. I've fished the beach since my father was, able to get me to hold a fishing pole in my hand. He never learned how to surf cast, so he loved to watch us fill up the back of his truck with bluefish, and boy, did we ever. ever since 68 and on up. But it's declined. I'm glad to hear you bring up the seals. I cruise the beaches every week. I do not go out in a boat. I'm constantly driving around this island, and the seal activity is tremendous. It's gone unchecked for, what, 45 years? So if you leave one species not to be harvested, these are the results. And, you know, I think if there's some way that you can advocate for a harvest of seals and make a use for them, Canada harvests them. I believe Alaskan Eskimos harvest them. Create a biofuel from them. Get the ethanol out of our fuel. Let's use seal oil. Thank you.
Yeah, this, regarding seals, just by coincidence, there happens to be a Marine Mammal Commission meeting in Woods Hole coming up at the beginning of April. I can't recall the exact day, April 6th. April 6th, at this commission meeting, the whole day is devoted to seals, gray seals notably. I mentioned before the meeting we had on Nantucket about a month or 2 months ago, Muskeget Island and elsewhere on Nantucket. We made a lot of important points at that meeting, where there were federal representatives and environmental organizations basically said over our dead bodies, are you ever going to have any kind of a color harvest of seals? But nevertheless, now's the time for some very important debate about what to do with gray seals notably. The Marine Mammal Protection Act basically says no way, no how. However, there are a number of people sensitive to the fact that when the Marine Mammal Protection Act was implemented back in 1972, the gray seals didn't exist in Massachusetts, very few. Now, of course, it's just unbelievably abundant and having an impact on the ecosystem. And so I continue to stress, you know, Ray, of course, stresses, and Dan as well, the need to focus on the impact of gray seals, notably on the ecosystem, on what they're eating, and how is this impacting the quality of recreational fishing opportunities? Because again, they harass catch. All I hear now is a charter boat captain bringing back the fish to the boat, and I bring back a head because the seal or the whole liver is gone. It's a significant problem. So for those of you who would like to be up to date as to what's happening with discussions about gray seals, marine mammals in particular, this particular 3-day meeting is open to the public. There's a website. You can go to the Marine Mammal Commission, probably find some documents that have been posted there. It should be very informative, and we'll see what some of the top scientists and those involved in marine mammal management are now thinking. As it relates to not just whales, that's one day, but on gray seals. So it's something for you to think about. Anyone else? Yeah, follow up? Yep.
I just wanted to say that it's the 4th, 5th, and 6th in Woods Hole.
4th, 5th, and 6th in Woods Hole. You may have to register to get in, but it's open to the public, so I understand. 5th, 6th, and 7th?
Thursday, the
6th. Okay, so yeah, Thursday, the 6th is pinnipeds, the seals, but I believe the emphasis is on gray seals for obvious reasons.
Gray seals. In 1966, I counted maybe 4. I counted 3 gray seals on Muskeget.
My wife and I spend time on Nantucket. I love Nantucket. I'm here quite often. And my house is loaded with Nantucket memorabilia and photographs and pictures. So not that that's relevant, but I mean, I've got an investment in Nantucket. I know about Nantucket's interests. And this past summer, we were walking the beach, Great Point, going to the south. We rented an off-road vehicle and did that. And of course, the seal heads are popping up all over the place. And so my wife looked at the seal heads and she said, you know, what are those? And I said, my goodness, I mean, obviously, they're seals. And she said, well, they're so ugly. And I said, wait a minute, you're thinking of the harbor seal. Are you biased against ugly seals? And she said, no. But the point is that, you know, the seals, as I noted, they have this obvious attraction. I have grandchildren, they love seals. So this is a big deal. And once we go into the arena of seal problems and how do we deal with these huge numbers and how do we make profitable and wise use of seals some amount, we're going to come face to face with tremendous public opposition and tremendous opposition from environmental organizations. And I know for a fact that if anything is done to change the Marine Mammal Protection Act to allow some sort of, you know, sensible harvest, there'll be a tremendous amount of opposition to that from groups that will think that the Marine Mammal Protection Act is being undermined. And that's not... Oh, all right. So with that said, apparently we have now Roger Hanlon. And Roger, of course, I know of Roger's research. I've read some of his papers. Roger was asked by Pete, I believe, if he would like to say something regarding spawning squid. He's done a lot of research on that. So, Roger, thank you for hanging in. And if you would, tell us what you have to say.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
And can you see me now?
Yes.
Yes.
Go ahead, tell me when the video is on, please.
We can hear you and see
you. Okay, great. Well, thanks for the invitation to help inform this discussion on behalf of the squids, as well as your local ecology. I'm in the Marine Resources Center at the Marine Biological Laboratory. This is a building dedicated to this sort of research, and we hold dozens of regional species, including squid. Much of our research has been done on squid to help inform fishery decisions, not unlike the ones that are being discussed today, and we've been especially interested in reproduction, because this is a short-lived animal, and it's important to bring some scientific facts to help provide what we actually know those squids are doing underwater. Just very briefly about my own credentials, I'm a diving biologist, I'm a field researcher, I do laboratory experiments based on my field work. Germane to this discussion, my colleague and I performed 136 scuba dives on the spawning squids in Nantucket Sound, and we've published an extensive paper on that. And the importance of mentioning that is that we've actually been able to quantify data what the animals are doing on the spawning grounds where all the action is as far as the squids are concerned. And we've repeated these experiments on a comparative basis on very similar, what we call lala-guided squids, are very similar to your local squid. We've done this in South Africa, Japan, California, and a few other places. So we have a very broad view of the principles of what these animals are doing underwater, how they lay their eggs, how those eggs develop. And these are really critical to the discussion today. We've also published a lot on this. So I'll get right to the point. It's very clear that trolling, or mobile gear in this case, certainly disrupts not only the eggs, but also the mating system of the animals organizing themselves in these very competitive mating arenas to do the spawning. Can you see this image by any chance?
Yes.
Okay, so you don't have to see the details, but the point is this is a diagram of what's happening down there on the eggs, and you see it's kind of like a busy airport with squids circling around in the periphery and then eventually pairing up and going down and laying eggs. It's, my point is that it's a very complex system, and there's a lot of intricate behavior going on. There are pheromones, i.e. hormones, that influence a lot of the behavior. And we've studied all this in great detail, but the culmination of this is the animals actually laying the eggs. And I want to make a strong point that all of the animals, all of the squids of this group called lala-guided squids, the female embeds the eggs into the substrate, into the sandy substrate, and there is a glue on those eggs which hardens in about 5 minutes. So the female tucks those eggs into the sand, the glue hardens, and the eggs go through their whole developmental process attached to the bottom. And this is critically important because the development of these eggs is somewhat delicate, and the eggs need to be attached to the bottom to go through the normal process of hatching out and being viable eggs. And so the key point here is that physical disturbance of those egg cases from a trawl or from a storm with a lot of surge and it displaces some eggs. An earlier speaker noted that sometimes eggs are washed up on the beach. That's from heavy storm surge in shallow water. Those eggs, none of those hatchlings will survive. Here is sort of the key image. I see what you see as a tiny squid, and that is a squid baby that's about to hatch out of the eggs. We've, you know, made this drawing from a squid that is, it says, stage 25. There are 28 developmental stages the squids go through to hatch. And I draw your attention to the yellow bits here. And that yellow bit there against the arms is an exterior yolk sac that the animal's been sucking on to develop for about 20 or 30 days. And then down here is an internal yolk sac that they will survive on for maybe the next week after they hatch out. And my point is that if the animal is disturbed, it's very sensitive. It will hatch out of the egg with that external yolk sac. But this is absolute death to a squid because the stomach cannot develop until all of that yolk is absorbed properly and their stomach develops. And if they hatch out before that, as if being trawled up or disturbed in the laboratory, and we've done this hundreds and hundreds of times, those babies will not survive. They'll be dead within 2 to 5 days. So this is not my opinion. This is factual information, and we know that because the embryology courses and the physiology courses use these eggs for study every summer, and every time they disturb the eggs in the late stages, they get premature hatching, and those hatchlings do survive. So I just want to kind of finalize and point out that those eggs are embedded in a jelly matrix. A lot of you know what the squid eggs look like, especially the fishermen. That jelly matrix that holds the 100 or 200 little egg babies together is very important. If that gets broken up or torn up in any way, then you know, local bacteria and other little protozoans, these little microscopic things, can get through the jelly and deteriorate it, and that will also lead to improper hatching. So I just want to finalize and point out that these squids are very fast growing. They only live about a year or much less than that, and so the annual turnover of the population is very important. Therefore, having all these squids move inshore to lay their eggs near shore, that's where the abundant food source is for the young that hatch out. Then they migrate offshore, they come back in. On an annual population, really must protect the spawning grounds so that enough animals reproduce in a normal manner so the gene flow through the system is good to get your best animals for next year's squid harvest. So we'll finalize, just say that the actual experiments to prove that a trawled up egg does not develop properly have not been done, but I will point out that because so many biologists, ourselves included, have worked on these animals so many times, we haven't done that experiment because we pretty much know what the answer is. However, those experiments could be done if you need that kind of proof to demonstrate to the fishery managers and to the fishermen and to the community that disruption is really fatal, then those experiments could be done. So thank you very much. That's the main thing I wanted to bring to the meeting today.
All right, thanks, Pete, for arranging that. You know, Roger's done a lot of great work. As I said, I've seen some of his papers. I'm going to have to talk to him some more about recent work and recent publications we may not be aware of. So thank you. The Mid-Atlantic Council certainly will benefit from that as well, since obviously they're focused on spawning squid region-wide. So good.
Like I say, I appreciate, I don't know if you can hear me, Roger, but so long. But anyway, I just think it's been an awakening fact since last September when we went down to Rhode Island, and Lisa Hendrickson was one that started it off. And again, it was just an unknown fact. And again, everybody forever, the guys that are dragging, and it worked. They were throwing the stuff back over in a hurry, thinking that it might be successful for them to still hatch. But as we've been gaining testimony, and that was what you were asking about, is testimony, so we have it from probably four or five sources, and including Roger, he's been around for a long time. So I would just, again, push the issue that we, you know, we've seen the issues change. I mean, for probably most of the guys that are fishing around here commercially, like when the bass were here, and now recreational and charters, but we're not seeing any of the small squid. And again, we just thought it would be a great thing to bring to your attention so that you can make wise decisions going forward. And through this testimony of Rogers and others, I think you need to consider that. And, you know, again, in your papers that you published before, and other papers, and testimony from some of the guys with the small boats, they say, look, we've got like a keychain net compared to a 72-footer. And so we catch maybe a fifth of what one of these guys catch. So also, the damage is that much greater also. So therefore, I think this, you know, like Bobby was talking about, we're trying to work with you. And as, you know, Matt said, that let's try it. Let's shut this part of it down and see if it does come around. And meanwhile, while the Mid-Atlantic is trying to work on these decisions, and hopefully that will go through, but at this point in time, we're seeing, as Freddie and others say, we're watching the fisheries and the marine ecosystem around Nantucket just one way, and it's going to hell. So we, you know, again, we're looking for not only us, your grandkids, bring them out here, and you know, you enjoy coming out here, but our kids and our grandkids, that's what we're looking for. And if we can start making that change and some attempt to change it now, that's what we're looking for.
Yeah, in light of the fact that the Mid-Atlantic Council still has on the table continued discussion about closures, one obviously one being the figure that I showed you, south of the islands, there'll be a need for us to continue our discussions, you know, with our Mid-Atlantic Council counterparts, with their staff, about, you know, squid spawning and the MOPs, and more discussion with Lisa Hendrickson, the center scientist, and of course with Hanlon as well, to get a far better understanding of squid spawning and the MOPs. It'll also be interesting to see how successful the squid fishery is this year in the spring, because if we have another banner year of squid, then it raises the question, well, then what was the damage to squid reproduction by previous years dragging on squid, be it in federal waters or state waters? So we'll see what happens, you know, happens this year.
Just one other couple little points. Like I say, I have the whole thing that I'm going to turn into you. I want to give a lot of people time to speak before the guys had to leave, so I just aborted my whole speech. But just a couple of things that I wanted to point out. Talking with Jason Didden from the Mid-Atlantic Council, and we were staying in pretty tight comms as this whole fishery was, you know, going on all summer. And the comments that he made to me when I said, you know, Jason, I'll bet you with that amount of pressure and larger unprecedented boats that close to shore where the weather will not stop them. Some of those boats fished every day. And in your report, I think you also mentioned that small boats will be shut down by weather. But anyway, I made a comment to Jason at one point and said, I'll bet you 75% of this whole trimester two was taken out of this close area. And with that, his reply was, try more like 90%. So that gives you an idea, and that's right out of the data from the Mid-Atlantic Council. And the other thing that, you know, we're trying to stress, like the guy was talking about from Dartmouth, but we're just saying we went at this because we looked at that whole chart, the state chart, and when we seen 3 miles, 3 miles, everything was a 3 mile closure, that's why we went for the 3 miles. But then it's kind of, you know, hypocritic or whatever. We're trying to help these guys out. But when we see all the opposition coming from basically three major ports, Gloucester, Boston, and New Bedford, when you look on that chart, all three of those ports have not 6 months of protection, but they have 12 months of protection on their state waters right outside the harbor.
I'm going to have to interrupt you on that one. I've already covered that base. Okay, there's no basis, in fact, for the closures that exist along other portions of our coast,
right,
being related to recreational fishing or for forage. It's got that long time historical, fascinating history,
right,
you know, of how it came to be. Off of Gloucester, for example, there are pages and pages of explanation as to how areas were closed, they were open, they were modified. It's got to do with fixed gear versus mobile gear. It's got to do with the lobster fishery. Yeah, the issue of equal protection doesn't really hold up in the context of Nantucket. You have other arguments that are good ones, but the one about equal protection just doesn't stand.
I guess that could be said, but the fact is, at this point in time, if either it be gear conflicts or whatever, the bottom line is that they end up with protection of, it may not have been intentional, but all of these places have 3 miles of protection for the marine ecology. And that's by default or whatever. But, you know, and knowing what we know about the squid mops and about damaging them and, you know, mobile gear, you know, bottom mobile gear, it's inherent in the beast that the habitat suffers.
I hear you, Pete. Right. I hear you, Pete. You make your point that we have some disagreements.
Yep.
But again, I'm learning a lot more than I knew before.
And as we said, it's not unhealthy to respectively disagree.
Absolutely. Dan?
Thank you.
Okay. Who else would like to speak? Yes, sir.
Hello, I apologize. I had to leave in the middle of it, so I hope I don't repeat what was already said. My name is Jason Malesko. I'm a charter fishing out here. My father started charter fishing in 1973 out of Matticat, and I've been fishing with him since 1996. And much of what I have to report is just anecdotal and observational, and to support a lot of what Pete's saying. But more in the short term, when we see the squid boats up, we do a lot of our fishing south of Muskeget, south of Tuckernuck in the Vineyard, in that opening. And in the last decade, in the last decade and a half, we've seen the number of squid boats just, you know, exponentially increase just off our south. And we know night and day when the season opens and closes. And last year, when you extended it that week, when the boats went out and they had their bycatch window, when those boats are south of us, we almost don't even go south Muskeget to try for those stripers. My problem is it. Is not the overall number of squid. It's almost the funnel effect of the squid trying to squeeze through those two islands, and they all have to get through that very small geographic range. And I feel like 15, 20 boats stacked in that spot, it's almost like a guillotine, a noose that they can't get through. So I think a lot of the fishermen go on the other port, a lot of the fishermen do on the east. My fishing's on that southwest corner. And when I see in the horizon 10, 15, 20, I mean, I've counted 30 trawlers on that 3 mile line. When they're there, squid don't get through, and more on a day-to-day basis, the squid don't get through, the bass aren't there in the water. And I fish light tackle surface, and it's night and day. It's hard to think. I see the seals, I see other things, but when those trawlers are there, I bring my people to Great Point. I don't even try that fishery. Yes?
Could you just mention what happened on the 27th of June, when that closed, what happened?
We did. We had a window where those trawlers weren't allowed there, and it was gangbusters last year. I mean, you can follow my Facebook page. I mean, Cam's back there too. He saw that.
When you say they weren't allowed there, because the fishery remained open.
Did it?
No, June 27th, trimester 2 was officially closed.
Yeah. Right, but it stayed open. And
it closed, but then it was about a week's period before the lawyers were all involved.
And that, yeah.
And it went back and forth about should they be able to fish, shouldn't they? And then they said, well, if they allow this, they're going to have to go to court and everything else. And by the time they were done trying to close up that loophole of 2,500 pounds.
No, so I can.
By regulation, that area stayed open at a 2,500 pound triple.
Yeah, well, so nobody fished it. Nope.
Right, so I can back up what Pete said from observation. Last summer was where, because again, I'm also a science teacher in the winter time. I'm an environmental science teacher, so I kind of like all, you know, the science behind all this stuff and knowing it myself. But last summer was the summer that I really got on board with the impact the squid fisheries are having, because when I saw, when those boats disappeared, there's about a 5 or 6 day window where they disappear. And again, I'm learning from Pete, and I'm learning from, and Cam's very involved, and learning from the what happened on the legal side of it. But I'm talking about from fishermen's side of it. Those boats were there, and then they weren't late June. For 6 or 7 days, those boats weren't there. And we had, you can follow on our Captain Tom's Facebook page, go there now. No, it was gangbuster fishing. We had squid jumping out of the water from a day to the next day. And then I thought it was because some sort of bycatch rule where they were allowed to go in because of they were allowed to get a certain amount of tonnage from bycatch again. I'm not sure about that. They came back, maybe July 2nd or 3rd, whatever the date was, and it shut down again. And so we were fishing between Waskewee and Muskeget. So I'm not sure why they stopped, but I do tell you they stopped. And we actually have it in notes because this is when I got really involved with it. And they were out of there for about 6 days, and on my Facebook, and I took pictures of the horizon and took pictures of the bass, and I go, it's amazing what can happen when these squid are allowed through. And so in terms, and I've had arguments, people tell me, the trawlers will say that the squid are on their way out then, and I vehemently deny, object to that, and my observations will say, I mean, if they were on their way out, it wouldn't affect us if they were south of us. But I'm just telling you, when I looked on that horizon, and I see 15, I see 20, I see 25 boats there, my heart sinks every time. Because these squid, it's not as if, I mean, if you push those same number of boats, let's say there are 10 boats, if you push them out a little bit, they still have the right to fish. They still can get those squid, but there are gaps in that net now, the squid can get through.
So
but
how many boats did you see when they returned, as you described?
High teens.
Okay, so it went from 40 to 50?
No, but I mean, the 30s is, and when I'm talking about close boats I'm counting. I'm not even including the far ones, but I'm talking about the close boats. Well, it's in sort of mid-20s to mid-30s on average. And then when they came back, it was probably low mid-20s, as if not everyone got the memo or not everyone wanted to make the trip back. Again, these are just what I'm seeing. I don't know what they were told.
What happened is the larger boats could not operate and make they could not make a profit on 2,500 pounds. So therefore, you didn't have quite as many, but they still shut down. The point is that they shut down the flow of squid that are trying to come in.
And so from where it was day the next day, and it's so from my point of view, it's so growing up on stories of the fall fishing here. My father used to run our business through early November, and we lost our herring out here. A lot of us know we lost the herring battle, and then we wrap up our boats mid September, and this fight is more about the June fishery, the late May through late June fishery we're losing, and I attribute it primarily to the squid. And it just from my observations. And even though this year was a gangbuster squid year, that's what I kind of cringe when you said, we'll see what the numbers say for this next year. Their catches can be wonderful, but it can still have a really detrimental effect on our catches if they're taking them all out of the funnel. It's just spatially. If they're all catching 90% of their squid in that one quadrant, that one square southeast of our island, the squid aren't coming into our rips.
That's in federal waters?
No, the three mile line. So yes, the federal waters outside 3 miles.
Yeah, therein lies part of the problem that we're trying to address, and that the 2,500 pounds as a bycatch, a federal bycatch limit, is too high. Uh-huh. It's a small scale directed fishery, which is why we have encouraged the Mid Atlantic Council to consider dropping that down dramatically to like 500 or 250 pounds, and that is going to be, I believe, in the public hearing document. That's going to be aired sometime soon. I can't recall the exact date. I believe the public hearing is going to be held in Hyannis, right? So that's what we've been supporting, dropping down that limit. Otherwise, the intensive fishing still occurs in federal waters right on the line.
Right, and also enforcement's a big thing because that's what we're here. we've seen plenty of boats inside that 3 mile line. Cam, you remember last summer? I mean, I caught on camera a boat in my GPS. I was 2.2 off, and he was right next to me. And it's there's only one boat coming around. You can't get everybody. And so, if there's anything we can do about increasing enforcement, that'd be a huge thing too. But I think I've said more than I had to say. So thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Doctor.
Yes, sir.
One thing I haven't heard here today, and we talk about sustainable industries, sustainable fisheries, and I mentioned that I spent a lot of time in the Gulf of Maine, and I've worked all Kennebunkport, Green Harbor, Provincetown, Nantucket, Point Judith. I fished out of all these ports. Sustainability, and again, we're talking about eggs and targeting spawning fish. The closures in the Gulf of Maine with spawning shrimp, ocean herring. The closures, where else in the world do we target a spawning species? This is one of the things that really bothers me. Even though, and I understand what you said about we'll see what happens this year, unfortunately, in my opinion, the wait and see attitude has been the greatest detriment to all the fisheries that we're involved in. I understand the science of gathering data. This is pretty simple.
By wait and see, I mean there are no changes in the federal rules for this coming spring season.
I didn't mean the bad thing.
I know. I just wanted to clarify that, you know, wait and see. It's not that I like to wait and see.
I understand.
But in this particular case, because the federal rules stay the same.
All I wanted to get out in this last statement was the sustainability of a fishery based on spawning fish. We have historically seen closures. Like I said, it starts with the shrimp, the herring, the cod, anywhere between Nauset and out to Georges. Those closures, as those efforts were reduced historically, those fish rebounded. We're on the opposite end of this spectrum. We're looking at a strong fishery, but again, we're weighing, well, when and how and where do we restrict the fishing effort to protect the species? And I've got to say something I haven't heard today either. The most important part of all of these fisheries, and one, there are two things that are important in any fishery, the fish and the fishermen. So we have to watch the sustainability, that word right there, and that's the only one I haven't heard today, and I wanted to get that out. Thank you.
Anyone else? All right, with that said, thank you very much for your attendance. Obviously, we knew it would be beneficial for us to come out here. We had to cancel the public hearing. We thought we had to come out here to get this sort of comment. So we shared with you, our perspective, and you certainly have shared yours. We're continuing to work with the Mid-Atlantic Council, continuing to fine-tune what we do in state waters, learning more all the time. Obviously, we're going to be vigilant this spring regarding the fisheries in state waters and outside of state waters to the extent that we can. Just stay tuned, I guess, and we'll see how this unfolds. I strongly encourage you to express your point of view, the Nantucket perspective, to the Mid-Atlantic Council, all right, because really, federal waters fishing is really what's the major factor in influencing what comes back to state waters, and of course what happens regarding spawning near state waters. Never mind in. Yeah, Pete.
David, can I just ask you a question? This year, has there been budgetary cuts which are going to cause a reduction in the amount of observed coverage in state waters?
Well, we have a problem with state waters sea sampling because we used to have a sea sampling program, relatively small scale, but it was useful, especially for the squid fishery. Our staff retired, and we have not been able to replace that staff. So that's why we're relying on federal waters observers and whatever observing is done in state waters by federal observers. It's not what we want. We know we need, and we have sought more sea sampling onboard vessels, within state waters, but at this point in time, it's not going to be at the level we really need.
So that being said, I just want to blip out one last little thing that I skipped over. You'll get it in, public response. One of the things I was going to say, and we talked about it quite a bit, Bobby and the rest of us, is that being said, with the lack of observer coverage, and it's very important, that scientific data. But in the lack of that a moratorium on extensions of small mesh fisheries in state waters past June 9th should be implemented due to the lack of observer data upon which a person could make a logical decision and not have a negative impact on both the spawning events and the marine ecosystem as a whole. This would also take the pressure off of DMF so as to not make a decision based on financial principles and instead stand the ground based on logical regulations that were passed in the early 1990s.
And first of all, thank you. Thank you for that. But don't forget, we don't make our decisions based on financial decisions. Obviously, it's influential because fishing is important in Massachusetts, commercial
exactly,
as well as recreational. But I hear what you're saying.
Okay.
Dan has a point to make.
I mean, we realize that your part of your job is to keep people fishing.
Mm-hmm. We couldn't afford to put somebody on a 3-day trip, which is what a lot of those boats are doing. Most of them are not
in state waters.
On the south side of the island, a lot of those boats are trip fishing. like 2 and 3 days.
In state waters?
In state waters, right.
Wow.
On the south side. Okay, yeah, so if we really want good coverage of what's going on out there, we our sea sampling program has never been able to provide that because of our limited staff. But we've had great cooperation from the National Marine Fisheries Service to provide us that data. And so the budget cuts are not relevant. It's really what will NIMS be providing in terms of observer coverage. And personally, I was really pleased that we were able to get 3 or 4 trips out of that area, which is way more than what the state could ever have provided. And they gave it to us even before the data were key punched.
Right.
So, I mean, as we... You know, what is a good squid fishery? A good squid fishery is one where the catches of squid are high and the bycatch is low, and the stuff going through the scuppers is low. And when we had what in my view was a delayed run last year, and we got the reports coming from the fishermen of some really high catches to the tune of a couple of thousand pounds of tow, guys were catching 10,000 pounds a day. To us, historically, that was a good fishery, something we should manage for. The new paradigm, what you're promoting, is removal of this forage species as a real problem. So our regulations aren't addressing that. We're not addressing escapement, per se, because our regulations really have addressed waste and bycatch and discard. So in the future, I expect the Mid-Atlantic Council to be tweaking their catch limits and seasons and quotas. And I think there's going to be some significant changes in fleet behavior coming from the Mid-Atlantic rule changes. You know, if things go as I think they might, we might see the directed fishery closed before the state fishery even finishes its season. You know what I mean? So,
right.
So that's what I'm waiting to see.
Right.
And as far as the in-state, out-of-state issues, I want to put this on the record. This agency can't write a regulation that is specifically trying to constrain out-of-state boats. The federal courts will be on us so fast under the Commerce Clause and the Equal Protection Clause. We've had plenty of experience back in the 90s dealing with this. In fact, there was a major federal court case about our permitting a squid processing vessel that was Rhode Island-based, and we came very close to losing that. Because we were limiting the number of permits that we were issuing. So the courts are really sensitive to states that even if we don't say write a rule that says, you know, non-residents can't do this, if the effect of the rule has a substantially greater impact on non-residents, we're going to be in for it. So I just want to let you know that if that's an idea that you have, well, let's just help out the Eddies and the Ronnies. We have to be really careful about the impacts of regulations because the federal courts will step in.
The one thing that everybody keeps, you know, I know there's anecdotal, but you were getting information from the fleet, which was basically, as Eddie said, anecdotal. We're trying to say things anecdotal. You can, I guess, prioritize on what's anecdotal. But the thing is that it's well known that those squid come from the outside, and to be able to move just a mile or two out to get to that 3-mile line. And by the way, when you give that extension of the, you know, the season from June 9th to June 15th, 16th, or further, they're still going to catch those squid. But the thing that's not going to happen is they're not going to have all the interaction with any of the rest of the ecosystem inside of 3 miles. And, you know, you may think that a sculpin, a sea robin, a small sea bass may not be that important because it doesn't have the value, you know, that the squid does. But again, that was one of the thoughts that had been discussed a lot and said, we feel like if we're going to start somewhere, just limiting, just as Doc, I think the administration back 2 years ago, there was a discussion that went on that said, after this point in time, we're going to go right back to the June 9th closure, and that's where it's going to be. So we'd appreciate that if that could happen. Thank you.
You mentioned the restriction we have in making regulations that impact or detrimentally impact non-residents over residents. Is there any converse sort of worry about, because we could document pretty well that the squid fishery is having a converse impact, detrimental impact on the island over non-residents? I mean, right now, the squid fishery is hurting the island more than that. It doesn't hold true for that. I mean, we have to protect theirs.
I would challenge yes, there have been squid removals. Again, we don't have an omniscient survey where we know where the squid are and where the squid are not. And I know that you all have personal beliefs that the young of the year squid are missing from the mm-hmm. from the ecosystem because of the removals of the adults. Yeah. But there really hasn't been any surveys that we can turn to corroborate that. Okay. So I'm just saying that when rules are enacted, and I don't want to sound political, but it's sort of like some things that Trump's dealing with in terms of the immigration bans. When people say on the record, you got to do this, and even if you do something and that's the effect, people are really sensitive to that. But we've been involved with court cases in the 90s, and you can't write a rule targeting non-residents. And I know most of the big boats, or some of the big boats, could be non-residents. And yes, Point Judith is a very important port, but we can't go down that road. We can't say, you know what, let's just manage this for the state boats.
Just worried because I think that if they're affecting the residents,
you're saying the non-residents are affecting the residents.
The boats that are coming into our waters.
Yeah.
Because if you look at that map.
But those can be boats. From New Bedford, from Hyannis.
Even out-of-state boats, though, coming in. If you look at that map, and again, I don't want to get out-of-state waters. You're right. I was talking, because I went to the Rhode Island meeting. I went to the Atlantic Coastal Council.
Yeah. So this is a migratory species that's managed primarily by the federal government and then secondarily by the state government. There really isn't a local aspect to this, and that's probably what frustrates you, but the laws aren't set up to preserve a portion of this migratory stock for local interest.
I guess if you look at that map with the squares on it, the second trimester, and the red square was right touching the vineyard and the touch.
Sure, we understand that. I'll be honest with you, if you were at that meeting back in the fall,
I was.
Even the fishermen who were involved and the fishing advocates,
they seem pretty.
They looked at that and said, "We get it. I mean, this is obviously a huge concentration of squid being taken out of that really discreet place." And they understood your concerns, and that's why I think going forward we might see some torquing of the trip limits and the mesh rules that I think some of these guys will probably accept because they understand your concerns. And the other thing that struck me is there was a lot of talk among the fishermen that the run that used to be off Long Island every summer seems to have shifted to the east. Mm-hmm. And maybe that's part of the reason it's gone from the orange squares to the bright red squares, because there's been a concentration of squid to the east. And that's sort of what, they're chasing squid wherever they are.
Yeah.
And so
we've tried to reciprocate that understanding to them as well. I'm trying to not make them not catch fish, just asking them to push out a little bit from our shores.
Yeah, I'm confident something's going to change, at the federal level on this. Right. David?
Thank
you.
Yeah,
it's very likely going to change, and I'll give you an example why. The closures, federal closures that I showed on the screen, the Area 1 and Area 2 from Martha's Vineyard to Nantucket, which is awful isolated. If you're going to have it, make it bigger than that, frankly. But anyways, the committee, the squid committee of the Mid-Atlantic Council, just voted it down. Now, Pete can testify to this.
They just
voted it down, but then it came back up to the Mid-Atlantic Council for general debate by all the members, and it failed on a close vote to have those closures as part of the amendment. However, they did agree that it should not vanish, that it should be in play, and it's likely going to come up again in further discussion. So my point is, the Mid-Atlantic Council in particular is sensitive to this issue. If they weren't, they would have just said, it's over and done with, we're going to wash our hands of it. And I think Pete, to some extent, had an influence on those discussions. And Captain John McMurray, he had an impact as well.
Thank you.
Oh, okay. Yeah, right, so you can see that the intensive effort in the May through August, those two time periods, off of Long Island, off of Block Island, it's inshore. These are rough areas, of course. They're large areas, but still, it shows how things have, I wouldn't say changed, but
in recent years, these areas have gone yellow, and red is really here now. So there is that, in the last couple of years, there's been that change.
Good
Yeah, it's a
recent map that is one of one brandy spot. Really
yeah, no, yeah. And what's also deceiving about this figure is it's combined 2011 and 14. That's 11, 12. That's 4 years. So, if we were to look at 14, 15, and 16, which they didn't provide in the database for the amendment, I don't think. Yeah, you might see an even brighter red, you know, to the east, and more yellow and green to the west. So, you know, something may be happening with squid overall in terms of its distribution in response to temperature, or, you know, who really knows? The Mid-Atlantic Council's struggling with this. And the Northeast Fishery Science Center scientists are trying to provide good advice, but they haven't been able to, you know, put their finger on it. The research is being done, not enough, but anyways, something has changed. And you've had some great observations, frankly, regarding that spot between Muskeget and Martha's Vineyard with that funneling effort.
Just yes, real sir. Quick, it seems that you're basing sort of your position on these potential future changes, which I think we all are sort of hoping to happen at the federal level. Is there an expected sort of time frame for those changes to happen? And if they don't happen in a sort of a time frame that you guys are looking at, what would you do?
Well, it's going to happen by the squid season of 2018. Probably whatever happens will be implemented this fall. Uh-huh. So it'll affect the offshore winter fishery in terms of how the quota is broken up, you know, the different trimesters. So we're focusing on that. We're tracking it. We're participating in those discussions, even though we're not formal Mid-Atlantic Council members. We have working relationships with staff and with council members in the Mid. So we're working with them on that, making them aware of our concerns. Certainly Nantucket's concerns have figured prominently in all the discussions that have occurred. As I noted, you know, Captain John, he said a public hearing should be held on Nantucket. Now, I was at that meeting when this discussion occurred. I was in the audience, you know, waiting my turn to speak, and I didn't have to say anything about Nantucket because here's the Mid-Atlantic charitable captain from New York raising his hand and saying, public hearing on Nantucket. It's going to be in hiatus, but it's, you know, that was a clear signal that the Mid-Atlantic Council is very much more aware of concerns to the east, notably in Massachusetts and certainly from this island and maybe Martha's Vineyard too.
Great, thank you.
David, one last thing just to try and understand or maybe help implement something. I think it's understood from the papers that both of you had written way back when that larger boats definitely cause exponentially more damage, potential damage to the bottom and through the squid mops. So that being said, and we know that on the outside of Nantucket, that it's a large boat fishery. So those boats, those nets are going to cause a lot more exponentially larger damage to the squid mops. So it's possible that maybe on the outside, if you're going to give an extension, give it on the inside, but yet we'll give it to the whole area, but also implement a time and area spawning closure on the outside. Therefore, they could close it June 9th. And if you foresee the reason that you had to give an extension, give it, but at the same time, say, look at this, what we've seen in the past, and the amount of damage that's being done by the large boats, we're going to put a time and area spawning closure on the outside of state waters.
Well, we can't regulate beyond 3 miles.
No, in state waters. I'm saying about when you give, you know, when the extension goes for a week, the extension goes for 10 days.
Uh-huh. Okay, yeah.
You know what? We realize the amount of damage that's being done by the larger boats on the outside to the squid mops, as we've got scientific evidence now. Say, look. The guys on the inside with the small boats say, hey, could you help us out? You know, we're seeing some squid here. You know, help us out for another week or 10 days. Say, okay, you can make your decision. Say, in Nantucket Sound, we're going to allow that extension. But on the outside, because of the size of the vessels, the size of the nets, and the exponential more damage to the bottom and the mops. I mean, these mops are crucial, I feel, at this point in time. There's, you know... So you say, okay, on the outside of 3 miles, outside the sound, time and area closure, it's done.
Yeah, Pete, you and others have given us just something to think about. Obviously, we've got a lot more to consider, you know, for this year, recognizing that new rules can't be implemented for this spring because there's a regulatory process and timelines in review.
The extension, of course, is in play. So we're going to, you know, take a close look at what happened last year, the nature of this comment here, comments elsewhere, and you, as well as your Bob, have offered up some other ideas about what could be done. So, again, food for thought. Thank you. All right. Thank you again.